Oh, I was not expecting that response. I forgot we have school children here today. Good afternoon. Yeah, thank you all for coming here for the seminar. The seminar is on water purification technologies, and the question we are going to debate today in the later part of the talk is, do we need really RO-based water purification systems? And you will learn about what is RO water purification system over the talks, and then at the end we will debate. So I think we all know how important water is for survival. In fact, we are not only looking water for on Earth, we look for on the Moon, we look on Mars to see whether there is really life. Okay. The first thing one searches is for water. So we know it's a very important topic. And in fact, it is said that the future wars will not happen over oil, but for water. So with such a dire situation, I don't think I can highlight more than that what is the importance of water technologies and why water is important. And recently, the Honorable Prime Minister is in his Mann Ki Baat. He addressed the people that to conserve water, to save water, and he has called for this Jan Shakti for Jal Shakti. That is the slogan he has given to all of us, that we should conserve water if we have to. And we all know about the crisis in Chennai, which really suffered in the drought, and there was no water available for drinking. So with this background, DGCSIR has shown interest that we should somehow convey this to the people, you know, to the general society, how important water conservation is. And when you talk of water conservation, there are multiple ways of doing it, like rainwater harvesting, you must have heard, and many other technologies. But what is also important is, even when water is available, many times it's unfit for drinking because of various contaminants and things like that. So you need to do water purification. Now, is there one solution for water purification, or there are multiple ways of doing it, and what decides when to use what technology? And doing the right technology at the right place, it will help you in conserving water also, indirectly. So these are some of the topics we are going to talk about today. And so we have a list of eminent speakers who have come all over from all over India to talk to you all about the various water purification technologies. So before I go to the first speaker, I would like to invite Dr. Shekhar Mande, DGCSIR and Secretary DSIR, to give his opening remarks.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to have all of you here. There can be no more pleasure than presenting our work to school children. And when we discuss as important topic as water, is even assumes much more importance. Very pleased that all of you have been able to come here at our invitation. And we are going to discuss, as I said, this very important issue on water. There are many different aspects will be discussed, as Geeta mentioned. And she also mentioned that how much emphasis does the government put on water conservation technologies. You know, I mean, all of us must learn to conserve water. Many of you would have heard in your school classes, textbooks and all, that the amount of water available for our use is only 2% of water that is there on the planet. You know, 90%, 98% water is not even available to us for use, very ready-made form. And even the amount that is available to us for use is now getting contaminated, has multiple different issues and so on and so forth. So it's very important for all of us to be aware what the issues are, and hopefully the panel of distinguished speakers are here, they will drive the point across to all of you. CSIR has actually planned a very interesting afternoon for all of you. At the end of the program, there will be some sort of a question answer session with the children. And I believe the children who ask the most interesting questions will be given some prizes. Yeah, so be ready for that at the end of the program. So welcome all of you once again. I'm especially thankful to all of our speakers who have come from all over India to talk to the school children about this issue. Thank you very much.
For your introductory remarks and welcoming the school children. And as Dr. Mande mentioned, so you will have to be awake during the seminar. So we'll ask you questions based on the seminar. So if you sleep through the seminar, you're not going to answer the questions. Okay. Having said that, I will introduce the first speaker, Professor Pradeep, T. Pradeep from IIT Chennai, who is an institute professor there. It's a very distinguished professorship. He's one of the few people to have been selected for that. And he's also the Deepak Parikh Institute Chair Professor at IIT Chennai. And he's done his PhD from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, has worked in UC Berkeley and Purdue in USA, and he has published 440 scientific papers, and he has many, many patents to his credit, and many technologies he has developed, which are being used by the industry and by common people. He is mainly interested in development of affordable technologies for drinking water, which I think is one of the important topics we are going to talk about today. What are the various water technologies? He has received many, many awards, and he is a member of the World Academy of Sciences, American Association of Advancement of Science, and Royal Society of Chemistry. I think I can go on and on about his credentials. So, and he has also interestingly written popular science books in Malayalam. Apart from being a very distinguished professor, he has also taken his time to write popular, and he was just mentioning that he has a Sahitya Academy Award also. So, I welcome Professor Pradeep to talk about what are the various problems and challenges we are facing in water. Professor Pradeep.
It's always a pleasure to come and talk about one's own science, which has large implications to people. And that, as Hqrs said, talking about that science to an audience, including students, is even more exciting. I teach normally students who are slightly of a higher age. But today is not a teaching, today is lecturing on things which are of larger importance to the planet. So obviously, some of these things will go above your head. Therefore, kindly excuse me, whatever that you can take, please take. Others, in case you didn't get something, please be alert to ask questions. And if I am not in a position to answer them, you please rate me appropriately. I'm not going to ask you questions, but Geeta will ask at the end. I'm here because of Shekhar Mande, who has taken this initiative to take this message of science, water, and especially think through as to what CSIR can do on water. This is a very large problem. The entire nation has to think about it, as the Prime Minister just talked about. Water in India, although is a very large issue, the amount of water we have is so tiny. We have just 4% of the global water, fresh water, with us, but 18.7% of the global population. So shocking that we have just 4% of water, 18+% of people. Obviously, it is going to cause tremendous stress on our this particular region. And that is obvious here. So the water stress in this part of the planet is much more than anywhere else. So this is the overall water risk plotted for 2014. If we were to plot this for 2020, this water stress will be such that many of these regions of India will be of this color. This is essentially Rajasthan. But this is, in fact, this region would spread all across. 67% of Indian agriculture is run on groundwater. Unbelievable. You know, the total amount of water, 80% of that is used for agriculture in any society, India too. And that 80%, 67% of that is run on groundwater. So in many places, the rate of decline of the groundwater resources is so rapid that every 2 years, in some places in China, not much different here, The water table is going down by 300 feet every 2 years. Now this is certain place in China, but here in Bangalore now, some of my friends are drilling all the way down to 2,000 feet for water. And as a result, when we go down and down, we are pulling out many, many things that we were not having in water. So I'm from a place called Kerala. We never thought that we would have fluoride in water, but fluoride has come to water. Just because we keep drilling deeper and deeper, and we break all the rocks there, and all those unexposed regions are exposed to water, flowing water. And this is happening everywhere. Apart from that, as Hqrs talked about, anthropogenic activities are bringing out many other issues. Some years ago, we were thinking that Gangetic Delta has this arsenic problem. I was telling our colleagues that arsenic has come to Tamil Nadu. So shocking that the diabetes-affected population in Tamil Nadu has increased above the national average. So shocking are the implications of this. Now, these implications can, of course, have a large health impact, can have impact on the entire society, but, of course, are there solutions? Are there solutions that science should address? Will that drive economies? And we will talk about that in the course of this lecture. The time is short, so I will not be going into these things in greater detail. But most important message that we should take home is that water is a closed cycle. The number of water molecules on this planet is so finite, it is just about 4.4 into 10 to the power 45 molecules. So it is just about 10 to the power 20 or so liters of water. Because there is no water that is coming out from the planet, there is no water that is coming into Earth from space, and we are not really throwing out much of water to space. So it's water is a closed thermodynamic system. So we are just changing this, and this is what you have studied as water cycle. But this water cycle is opened because we are really not in a position to close it well because of anthropogenic activities, and I will come to that. This is essentially the core of the problem that we are facing. If you take water and carbon dioxide combined, you get sugar and oxygen, and this is what plants do in presence of sunlight. And this is a huge, massive exercise that happens. Till about 200 years back, we were taking that amount of sugar and oxygen back to water and carbon dioxide in some closed fashion. So essentially, the number of water molecules used were really produced back. Carbon dioxide used, we produce this carbon dioxide back. If you start looking at it, the amount of carbon dioxide is so huge. It is 258 billion tons of CO2 is used annually. So that you can do a small calculation of this and say that 105 billion tons of water is used per year. Huge, huh? This is, one ton is 1 10 to the power 3 liters, 1,000 liters of water. Now, it is not that this is the only thing that is produced. Hqrs and people like that would know that we are producing a lot of alkaloids, terpenes, a number of other molecules, not just carbohydrates. Many other things are also produced in this cycle. You take this cycle back, and this we call nature, and this we call life. right? Our human life, animal life, we take this back. But then we can take this cycle through petroleum, because these guys go to petroleum and they are untapped reserve, people would have told you, but we can take it through civilization, industrialization, factories, and then produce carbon dioxide and in an accelerated fashion. In so much accelerated fashion that 29 billion tons of CO2 are produced annually. So this cycle is now upset because we can't fix this excess CO2. This excess CO2 that we cannot fix has contributed to our problem. Now, we have to also think about this, that it is not that this water is here and then this is taking back to water. We have produced people. These people require water. And the current requirement, well, the current level of technological development, we require 31 billion tons of water for our 1.7.2 billion people. So this has caused additional stress on the planet. Now I'm talking about this amount of water, considering the water requirements of India. If I were to take the American water requirement and project it for the world, this will be something like 4 times higher. So that much of water, obviously, we just don't have. And that causes tremendous stress. And question that is asked is that, are there technological solutions? Are there nanotech solutions? Are there unknown solutions that we have? And we have written something about this, and this is what we will be illustrating in the course of this lecture. And obviously, all of this is a lot to do with sustainable development goals, especially we are talking about this goal number 6, clean water and sanitation. In fact, there is a look in the audience and all would know that there is nothing in this without water. Everything is connected with water. No poverty is water problem. Zero hunger is a water problem. Good health is a water problem. Education is a water problem. Gender equality is a water problem. So almost everything is a water problem. Of the 16, of the 17, 16 are directly related to water. So look at this India's problem. I told you about the large global picture. Here is the water demand, and here is the water supply. Now, the demand is this now in 2013. Now you see, we are in huge deficit. Now, our average per capita water availability in cubic meters was somewhere here in 1951, this is Indian data. It has come to about 1100 or so, somewhere here. And if we project it like that, India will be one of the most water-stressed countries. And India's of the 304 or so rivers that we have, 275 are polluted. And I map one river in Tamil Nadu from its source to the sea. And I see how the pollution is changing. And you look at these opportunities. While this is true, we have 62 kilomillion liters of treatment capacity, well, sewage generated, of which only 24 kilomillion liters is all that we can treat. So almost double or more than triple, something like triple, the capacity we need to have. And that requires a lot of resource. Obviously, a lot of money can be generated. Now, while we talk about this water stress, we should also be aware that nature has been kind to us. So here is from 1901 to 2015, average Chennai rainfall. You can take this data, this open data available for Delhi as well, for any other city. And you see that it is almost there. In fact, we are getting a little more rain than these days than the last 100 years average. So nature has been kind, but we are facing water stress. Because this is what we had, but we have changed over the years. Larger reason for that is population. So you see the rational, the census of last census data, and I projected it for all these years. You see, this is what has happened to our population. But along with that, what has happened to our water resources? So this is an animated map of one of my colleagues, Professor Ivergo. So this is from 1893 to 2017. So you see what has happened to the water, available water reserves of Chennai city. It is, you will see in a minute what is happening. 1973, all that has gone. And 91, it is almost gone. 1991, 2000. 2006, 2017, this is what has become. From 12.6 square kilometers in 1893 to just 3.2 square kilometers in 2017. Now this is getting prepared for the nation, for what has happened to our water resources. So shocking, while this is happening, we have exploded. So this is Georgetown of Chennai. Globally, if you were to look at this projected, this stress is being felt everywhere. So I'm plotting the carbon dioxide data 8 lakh years ago to today. Now in San Francisco, just last week, the carbon dioxide level was measured to be close to 414 ppm. From an average 210 ppm to 415 ppm. And many people say that by 2100, we will be somewhere close to here. At this rate, or it could even be that, if we don't impose restrictions. That rate, where will we be? At that rate, I took this picture to show you where we can be. This is the picture of Venus. Now, you know what is the surface temperature of Venus? Correct. 467 degrees centigrade is the surface temperature of Venus. That is largely because of what? It is because of global warming. Because of greenhouse effect, in fact. It is the CO2's greenhouse effect has taken Venus to that temperature, because 96.5% of Venus's atmosphere is CO2. And if you put a lot of CO2 of this kind, about 600 or 700 ppm of CO2, we are going to cross something like more than 12 degrees centigrade in average surface temperature in our planet. Such is the shocking thing that we are faced with. So you keep all these in the background when you start looking at water, because one of my friends used to tell me that in a glass, in a bottle, or in a drop of water, you can see the entire civilization. You can see the history. You can see all the sciences in that. All that you have is a little bit of imagination. So if you look at this graph, many of the implications that it can have on the planet will be obvious to you. We should also not forget that water is incomplete without this table. Because if I were to take the number of elements in our body, almost all of these exist in our body. Well, many of these are man-made, all these blue ones. But otherwise, they exist in our body. So we can't just be throwing out something from water, because this is essential. Many times, 40 elements are micronutrients. And this is important to realize in the context of our. So what are these nanotech that we can do in the context of water? From Pedro Alvarez's paper, I see that anything, pathogens, turbidity, heavy metals, hardness, oxyanions, pesticides, trace chemicals, salts, all of these can be handled by nano-enabled technologies. We don't have time to discuss all of them. But what are those larger pointers? So if you start looking at these large issues, in the context of when you start looking at it from the point of view of science, you see that there are opportunities. 76 million tons of CO2 are emitted by desalination plants alone. I'm talking about the electricity consumption in desalination plants. If you can use this CO2 to make methanol through water, in fact, a completely new technology is out there to be made. And how much of methanol is being used by the planet every year? 75 million tons of methanol. So can this be equated? New technologies have to be born. So how do you make a CO2 to methanol? CO2 to methanol, in a sustainable fashion, you make it by splitting water with photovoltaics and make hydrogen and combine this hydrogen with CO2 and make methanol. And CO2, of course, is coming from all our sources of power production. Now, this is not the only big technology that you can do. Here is something a new zeolite people have discovered. So this is something called metal organic framework. Some material, a sponge-like material, which absorbs water selectively in the night. And in the daytime, when it heats up, it releases that water, producing clean water. How about producing something new? Well, is it possible to extract so much of water from the atmosphere? Yes, we have over 1.9 billion liters of water per person in the atmosphere. So there is no harm in taking out some water from the atmosphere. But is that all? There are completely new materials which can scavenge water and give them to plants. And these are super hydrogels. There are completely new desalination technologies which do not require membranes. And these can work on photovoltaics. One such technology is called capacitive deionization technology. And so there are several new such things have happened. So what did we do? It's not something that, all of these are not something that we are doing. We have worked on materials and built technologies. Now, if you start looking at that, materials-based technologies, there are plenty of opportunities there as well. We have 80 million people suffer due to arsenic. 130 million suffer due to fluoride and several other things. So if you look at all of these contaminated issues, there are issues that can be solved with materials. And we worked on that. Many other things are written here, but I don't have time to tell you. So what did we do? Some youngsters, like these people in the laboratory, found new materials and converted them to products. So here is an example. This is a filter that was made with about 7 kilograms of some powder we made in the lab. And this thing removes arsenic from water. So this pump is in a district called Nadia district in West Bengal. And a cemented bench, if you look at deep, you know, in detail, you would find a red colored stain. So this is iron oxide. So this red oxide that you see, it is an indication that there could also be arsenic. That is not essential, But in this particular place, it contains about 60 ppb of arsenic. The limit is 10 ppb. But there are many places in this particular district where the arsenic concentration is over 200 ppb. Now, it is possible that this boy at the age of 6 or 7, if he pumps this water, one stroke of the pump produces 300 ml of water. And without any additional pressure drop, meaning additional work done, he could take this water through this filtration column and produce clean water in 1 second. For 1 or 2 seconds of contact time, you could produce this water. What it means is that you could install this filter in the schools. So we installed this thing in 330 schools as a trial. One school has 300 children. And 300 children take water, of course, their neighbors take water. So this filter delivers 1,000 liters of clean water every day. And it runs for 1 year. And in places, it runs for 2.5 years when the arsenic concentration is lesser. And after that, you have to change this material that is put here. So what is the essence of this? The essence of this is to create new materials which are selective in removing contaminants. So you could put this in fluoride affected areas where if you have such a material available for fluoride removal, this can be done, or nitrate or something else. So this is in general what one would say as use of nanomaterials for clean water. So we call, why do we then use nanomaterials? Why not some other materials? Because nanomaterials have certain very interesting properties. So this is a piece of gold. In fact, these are small particles of gold called gold nanorods. For all practical purposes, they are like completely different, let us say, compounds. So you take benzene. You know, you might have seen benzene. But a similar material or similar molecule is called toluene, but completely different properties. Anthracene, naphthalene, they're all different, but all of them are made with carbon and hydrogen. Here, this particular particle, which is of this particular shape, made of gold, is completely different from another particle, which is spherical in dimension, spherical in shape, or cuboidal in shape, or triangular in shape, or tetrahedral in shape. So by changing shapes, you can get completely different properties. In fact, all of them will behave exactly like different molecules. What does it mean? And one molecule has one property. Toluene has one property, benzene has some other property. Similarly, these particles have different properties. Now, in general, nanomaterials are used because of their unusually new properties. And in the context of clean water, we use it because water is very cheap. And any technology to produce water should be cheap. So in order to make something cheap, you have to get more property extracted from the same amount of material. So let us say this is a piece of material, bulk material, you cut this into pieces, several pieces, for the same unit mass, you have larger surface area. So large surface area means you can have put more molecules or more contaminants on the surface of these materials. So that would mean more adsorption, you say. But this is not the only thing. Several other additional properties can be put in. You may not have heard about many of these, so therefore we will not get into these details. There's something called gold, which is emitting red light. Gold emitting red light, have you heard of? It is not common. You have heard of gold, which is glittering. But there is gold, when you shine light on it, ultraviolet light especially, instead of being black, it will be red in color. So this is called luminescence, just like the luminescence that you have seen in planes or in the cinema theaters. When the light goes off, you see this green light which would guide you to the exit. Similarly, these materials are luminescent, but not green, but they are red luminescent. So this is a completely different property. This is something that you may not have heard of. This is something called quantum phenomenon. Just some kind of, some keyword. But many such properties exist in materials. The other important aspect is that when limits of contaminants are going down and down, like in arsenic, it is going down to 10 parts per billion or 1 part per billion for many contaminants, extremely low levels, pesticide, 0.5 parts per billion, is it possible that materials can remove these contaminants? No. Permissible contamination is actually declining. Permissible contamination in water, drinking water I mean, is declining with time because we keep understanding properties of these contaminants in greater and greater detail. We know that arsenic today is a risk even at something like 170 parts per trillion. And people have studied this in great detail. But is it possible then materials to remove these contaminants at such concentrations? So I give this kind of a story to people. Alok has heard this before. So here is a glass of water. This glass of water has 10 moles of water. One glass of water is about 180 ml of water you take. 180 ml of water is 10 into 18 ml of water, or 10 into 18 grams of water. 18 grams of water is 1 mole of water. So 10 into 18 is what? 10 moles of water. So how many molecules of water? 10 into Avogadro number of water. 6.02 into 10 to the power 23 into 10. That is 6 into 10 to the power 24. I take it as 10 to the power 25. So of this 10 to the power 25 molecules which are present here, how many contaminants are permitted? So some of the very, very toxic contaminants that we have produced by anthropogenic reasons or activities, the contaminants permitted is 10 to the power 12 molecules only. What is 10 to the power 12 out of 10 to the power 25? It is 1 out of 10 to the power 13. 10 to the power 12 out of 10 to the power 25 is 1 out of 10 to the power 13. 1 out of 10 to the power 13 is what? What is India's population? 1 billion, 10 to the power 9, let us say. An approximate number. 10 to the power 13 is 10,000 Indian population. One contaminant out of 10 to the power 13 is like one terrorist out of 10,000 Indian population. Can you remove one terrorist from 10,000 Indian population? Very hard. Think about an airport entrance door, and 10 to the power 13 molecules are walking in. People are walking in, and you have to pull out one terrorist from that. And that too, you have to remove this terrorist in 1 second because nobody is going to stand in front of a water purifier and get a glass of water in 1 million years. The person wants that water in 1 second. In 1 second, all these molecules have to be screened to remove that contaminant or that terrorist. So this is an extremely difficult task. And this, many people say, is molecular nanotechnology. Contaminant-specific molecules have to be built, but it is possible to be done. We have not used such technologies, but it is possible, and in fact, such technologies are available, not at commercial scale today. What is a contaminant? What was the contaminant of arsenic in 1959? 200 parts per billion. It has come to 10 parts per billion in 2001, in many parts of the world, we are still following in several places 50 parts per billion. But there are several countries wherein they limit arsenic to less than 2 parts per billion. Because we know that arsenic is toxic. Now, is it possible to remove arsenic at that concentration? There are many materials which can do even better. I told you about molecular materials of this kind. Here is one such material which removes, which changes color from this to this, which you can't see probably from a distance, just with 9 ions of mercury. Just 9 ions. So here, in this hall, there is an oven. In his institution, there are people who remove one molecule, specifically from contaminated water by new materials. One such thing, their people do something called molecular imprinting. But here, people do channels. And through these channels, you can selectively pass only water. And such channels have been introduced or can be embedded in membranes, and they are already available. Now, what are then molecular nanotechnology possibilities? New adsorbents, new sensors, new catalysts, new phenomena, new devices, and many things are there. And two journals are now, not two, there are more journals today discussing nanotechnology in clean water. So this is a book on nanotechnology in clean water which we wrote some years ago. But there are many, many things happening. So some of these technologies that are now talked about or discussed in laboratories and which became PhD theses have become companies now. And many are coming. So in that process, you can do fantastic science. You can develop technology, as I said. You can take those technologies to people, and obviously you can think something for the future. Here is one thing that we do. These are called molecular nanoparticles. In fact, they are so precise. This is a particle made of silver with some protection and all that. But we can precisely make this, just containing 29 atoms of silver. Why so 29? Because 29 has some interesting properties. 32 has some other properties. 25 has some other properties. So we can precisely make these nanoparticles now. And science has advanced so much that we can today measure this 25 atom gold particle in a mass spectrometer, an instrument with which we can weigh this mass of that can be measured. So you might wonder, nanoparticle science has advanced so much that there is no 24 or 23 or something. So only 25 is present. Synthesis has advanced tremendously. You can make such materials and crystallize them, just like Hqrs used to do. I don't know that he's doing now, but Hqrs is doing years ago crystals, you know, proteins and all that. So you can crystallize these. And you can put this in the mass spectrometer and get beautiful peak. I told you that peak, if you expand it, you get a number of other peaks which are all due to the isotopes of various atoms present in it. What I wanted to tell you is that by looking at this, nanoparticle chemistry or physics or material science can be understood with a lot of precision these days. So what does it allow you to do? I'll show you one paper. We can make materials and make water clean. So what did we do in this paper? We just made highly porous materials through which a contaminated water, when it passes through, it removes bacteria, viruses, arsenic, lead, mercury, all that, and get clean water. We will not discuss the details of it, but to tell you that several contaminants are present in water. 21 species regulated by EPA are halogenated organics. 15 species regulated by EPA are metals. 13 are organochlorine pesticides. If you count all of these yellow ones, you will get 92 species. All of these and many other candidate contaminant lists which are coming into water, they can all be regulated by nanomaterials. So we showed long ago that it is possible to break pesticides by nanoparticles. Now what did we do in this paper? In this paper we said that if contaminants can be removed by nanomaterials or something, is it possible that you can make some material in water, in starting with water, no solvents used, and no electricity used, can you make materials which are you know, useful for cleaning up water, starting from soluble ingredients and finally making insoluble water filtration materials, all in water, all at room temperature. Okay, what does that mean? Think about this material, which is polystyrene. Polystyrene is used in water purification. And in the process of production of polystyrene, it uses water. Polystyrene, of course, in its useful life, it removes a number of ions and which is used as ion exchange resin. But finally, it has to go back to environment. In that process, you destroy or you consume water. So net water purified, net amount of water purified is oftentimes negative. Is it possible to have water positive materials? So we said that we can have water positive materials made in water. 1 liter of water used for the production will make 500 liters of clean water. Okay. It is water-based, it is room temperature synthesis, no power utilized, it is water-stable, therefore it is green. What does it mean? Think about some polymers which are put in water. Think about these polymers as proteins. And these proteins, that you encounter these proteins in shellfish. They take up calcium, they take up carbonate, and finally, they make calcium carbonate, and it is insoluble in water at room temperature. They make this. Can we make such materials useful for water purification? So we made such materials. What is so good about such materials? We showed that it will release silver ions selectively at this concentration. At this concentration, it will destroy bacteria. But normally, if you create such materials, they will release silver ions, but in regular water, the silver ion concentration will decrease in just about few tens of liters or few hundred liters. This will create or generate, release the silver ions continuously for thousands of liters of water. So continuously, you can have whatever disinfecting activity, and that you can see. So these are live bacteria which become dead. Now you ask this question, will silver particles used in these materials, will they release silver nanoparticles? They don't release silver nanoparticles by a number of experiments we have shown. But it is possible that this bacterial concentration decreases, iron concentration decreases, lead concentration decreases, arsenic concentration decreases, and all that you can do. You can also generate new materials. So here is a new material which are nanostructured, which selectively removes arsenic. And how good is it in removal? 12 grams or 15 grams of this material can remove arsenic all the way up to 1200 liters of clean water it can produce. And that is the input arsenic concentration, 200 parts per billion. It reduces to less than 2 parts per billion for 1200 liters. So can you set up this kind of thing? Yes, we have set up. How does it work? These specific surface planes, we say, of these nanoparticles, these ions go and interact. And you can create a particle and its model can be constructed, how arsenic sits on it. What does it mean? You can convert that into a technology. You can put it in the field. This was a test very long, long ago that we conducted. And then it went to several districts here. This is one district in which we took up this study. 100 locations we took up, and these are all marked here. The district is called Murshidabad district. This is a traditional treatment plant utilizing alumina. Because these materials have large absorption capacity, this treatment plant spread over 40 cents of land can be converted to something in 7 cents of land. So this is exciting. So you can put this up in several parts. Now this went to Punjab. So this is one such unit that is there in Punjab supplying water to 1,500 people. But it has now spread. The cost of delivering water is 2.1 paisa per liter. And the government is ready to implement this So if there is arsenic contamination in a region, the government will go and implement this plan. And there are several such things that I told you before. And you can study this performance report done by somebody, and all these are local offices, they do this. In Punjab, this kind of units are now implemented in 83 locations, delivering 10 million liters of water every day. So what it means, this is 10 million liters of water every day at that cost, and this many hours of operation, etc. So it's great, but it has to have water. Without water, obviously you can't clean. Now, you have to invent new technologies where there is no water at all. You have to find new methods. So we have been working on those. People have written about this with photovoltaics. The power required is coming from photovoltaics. So we have units of this kind. Of course, there are several other technologies we work on. I'll leave this aside. Just to tell you that the units of this kind also require sensors. Can you have a sensor attached to your mobile phone? And this is biochemical. So these are called biosensors, similar to the glucose sensors that you use or your parents use every day. Now such sensors have been developed, and they can be converted to something like this, very interesting devices. And the clusters I showed you, which are brightly luminescent in red, can be put into membranes, and these membranes are sensitive to mercury. So this is real-time experiment. This can be converted to devices. It is not just that one. There are many other sensors that are put into this. And what does it mean? Tomorrow, water purifiers, we say, water purifiers will be smart devices. And that will communicate with the central location, the water quality. And if it's 365 days, if you measure the water quality, it is possible to predict the health. And that means it will become big data. The nation will have all these data at a central location, which means how programs are implemented for people can be assessed, evaluated. What next? I mentioned about clean water. That, of course, can be cleaned, but water has to be made. How about water harvesting? So we create atmospheric water harvesters just like the grass. So you know, in the morning, if you have walked, you would see that water condenses on grass, dew. And that is happening because of nanostructures on grass. And when these are cooled below the dew point, which is typically about 23 degrees in Chennai, you collect water. And that happens somewhere around 2 a.m. in Chennai in some months. And we can create these structures, and they are very similar to grass, I told you, or certain insects, or certain kinds of leaves. And they can be used to construct an atmospheric water harvesting device. Water is coming in the form of humidity, and that is put on surfaces which are having nanostructures. They are cooled below the dew point, and you get water, and that is today produced. Membranes can be as thin as this, one single atom sheet. And you can make holes in that, and you can see those holes, which are very tiny holes. Is a one atom thing, and what you are seeing are atoms. We have microscopes to see that, and there are many microscopes in the country. And what we have shown, this is molybdenum sulfide. If you have heard about molybdenum sulfide, this is very similar to graphite. If you make a hole in that, the surface of these holes are composed of molybdenum. And what happens is that if you shine light on it, that molybdenum oxide, molybdenum will produce hydrogen peroxide. Hydrogen peroxide will destroy bacteria and viruses, and you can get clean water. And we do this experiment, passing bacteria containing water through molybdenum sulfide coated these kinds of granules, which are holes, and you can get clean water by removing bacteria which are destroyed by hydrogen peroxide. This is not the only thing. There are many, many other technologies. RO will produce, remove all ions. But is it possible to put ions into water? And we know that in Ganges, Ganges is flowing through rocks, which are adding up ions. Can you have rocks of the kind which will selectively add minerals into water? We do that. So, I'm concluding by saying that we can solve all drinking water problems affordably and sustainably. Technology is there. But better mechanisms of monitoring are needed to ensure that the nation is healthy, and that requires new technologies. Affordable and sustainable solutions for water harvesting is needed in many parts wherein there is no water. Of course, technology has to be delivered. Now, water is only one side of the problem. I told you that it is. The other side of the problem is CO2. And that is to do with air. And collectively, one has to handle both water and air together. And that is not just one person's effort, or one institution's effort, or one nation's effort, because water has no boundaries of nations. Air has no boundaries of nations. So sustainable water is an issue of development. It's an issue of human aspiration. Everyone wants to become Americans. Everyone wants to consume that much of water, have better bath of the kind that Americans do. But population is expanding. Do we have water? One has to limit growth. One has to self-impose limits on growth on oneself. Can we do that? So we can have a lot of solutions, and we can address a number of measures by which water can be conserved. But ultimately, we have to think about sustainability. And that sustainability would impose a lot of restrictions on ourselves. Now, I have one parting message to tell you. This is something that we are making in the laboratory, which consumes CO2 that we are breathing out. The CO2 that we are breathing out in a room, can we absorb that and convert that to sugar so that by the end of the day, or in 7 days, or 1 week, or 1 month, can we have a biscuit? Can we make food from our own CO2? It is indeed possible. There's a small biscuit that we make in the laboratory. In 25 years ago, when I was, Geeta, I'll take 2 more minutes to conclude this. When I was walking in this village long ago, 30 years ago, if I were to tell my mother that, mother, while walking, I was talking to a friend in America, she would have told me that, fellow, when did you get mad? Today, you can walk, talk, you can do whatever, right? 10 years, 20 years later, I'm telling you that you will make biscuit with your own CO2. And you will not only have it, you will buy it from the factories. You will buy it from your consumer stores. And if that happens, that kind of technologies happen, I say that water will be data of tomorrow. Bangalore lives on data. Bangalore lives on data. But is it possible that water can be data of tomorrow? That means that water should drive to new economies. I'll show you an example. Is it possible to have IC engines to produce liquid water? If IC engines can produce liquid water, we can, in India, make 200 billion liters of water every year, because that much of octane we consume. Can we use CO2 to CHCOH? I told you about. point of use recycling is a big business. In fact, it is more than a $1 trillion business. Capacity desalination can completely change things. Is it possible to have a water audit of consumer products? Is it possible to have a national policy on detergents, what detergents to use? How can we have that? That means that new detergents have to be born. You have to make it. Affordable detergents, nanotech-enabled water infrastructure. Existing water infrastructure is the largest asset that we have. Can we make it such that water will flow through that infrastructure without resistance? Can we have nanosensors on packaging, all these bottles that or glasses that we have, can we have nanosensors to tell us what is inside that? Can we have clean air, clean environment, next generation membranes I told you about, nanotech for water conservation? Can we have water conserved in a small powder that will take up this water that is coming from the kitchen or something? So there are innumerable opportunities. You put all of these together, water can drive Bangalore. Water can drive Hyderabad. Water can drive Chennai. We have been building this kind of science in a lab like this, and it is beautiful, fantastic now, but it has all been built with passion. And I have a movie on this, but I don't have time to tell you. People have written extensively about these, and all this was possible at IIT Madras under my great director, Bhaskar Ramamurthy. Is a fantastic place, celebrating 60th year now. My students, several of them are owners of companies today, and have a large group doing many other things other than water. But water has been exciting, and if there is water, of course, there is future. Thank you very much.
Take it a level and take it to a product which actually makes a difference in people's lives, taking us through the entire journey, and also talking of the new technologies which we can see in the future, like taking our own CO2 and making food. I think that's really fascinating. And I think maybe some of these students will work on these kind of problems in future when they become the scientists. Thank you again for making it so clear to the, coming down to the level of the students, because it's not easy on the complex topics you're working. Thank you again. Now we can have Dr. Swachha Majumdar, who is from Central Glass and Ceramic Research Institute, Kolkata. Dr. Majumdar has mainly developed on biofiltration technologies, and he has developed many technologies of water purification, which has been licensed to the industry. And he has worked on developing ceramic membrane-based technologies for the water purification. He has many awards, like Diamond Jubilee Award for the best technology, and many publications and patents. And I request Dr. Majumdar to talk.
आप लोग को स्कूल में कौन सा पानी पीते हैं? What kind of water you are drinking in your school and home? फिल्टर? कौन सा फिल्टर है?
कैन
तो कंपनी है. उसके अंदर क्या है? What is that inside that can? किसने बोला आरो? आरो है. Today's discussion is to bust the myth about RO. मैं ये नहीं कहूँगा RO खराब है, लेकिन RO सबसे अच्छा है, RO mandatory है, RO के बिना कोई जीवन वो आपका हो गया है. ऐसा बोला जाता है ना, आपका घर में क्या केंट है, तेरा घर में नहीं है यार, तो ऐसा नहीं है, तो आपको ये समझना चाहिए. ये क्या है?
रिवर.
ये क्या है? पानी है. पानी से पाइपलाइन से सप्लाई हो जाता है. ये क्या है? यहाँ पे पंप्स वगैरह है. तो विदाउट पंप यू कैन नॉट ड्रॉ द वाटर फ्रॉम द रिवर और पॉन्ड or from the ground, large quantity. Small quantity you can use hand pump. What is this?
Treatment plant.
So you can see how big a treatment plant is. Millions of liters are being produced. Huge expenses to treat this water. So, be it river water, be it surface water, be it ground water, basic is that some treatment process, then storage, then goes to distribution system. In many places, city and urban area, municipalities, they have distribution system. Pipeline se pani bhar jata hai. Road ke upar tap rehta hai. Aapka ghar mein nal ka bandobast kiya jata hai. Aap underground reservoir lagate ho, wahan se ghar mein pump karke chhat ke upar storage lagate ho. Uske baad kya karte hain hum log? घर पे कैंट, ये जो शुद्धिकरण हुआ है पानी का गवर्नमेंट ने किया है, उसके बाद घर में हम कैंट लगाया, हेमा मालिनी लगाया, एक्वागार्ड लगाया, लिप प्योर लगाया, उसमें कौन नहीं है, टाटा बिरला सब है, तो ही है. ये ट्रीटेड वाटर है लेकिन हमारा मन में डर है, वी आर अफ्रेड. वो ट्रीटमेंट के बावजूद भी उसमें कंटामिनेशन है, तो घर में उसको प्यूरिफाई करके हमको पीना है. अच्छा, इट इज गुड बिकॉज वो हेल्थ के वजह से वो हो सकता है कभी कभी वो ट्रीटेड सीपेज है, वो है, सम प्रॉब्लम्स आर देयर इन डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन सिस्टम. तो आपने एक एक्स्ट्रा सेफ गार्ड किया है घर में, स्कूल में, सब जगह किया है. उसके बाद क्या होता है, कंज्यूमर्स हैव फाइनल फेथ ऑन मेम्ब्रेन बेस्ड सिस्टम, क्योंकि इसमें क्या है, मोस्टली ज्यादातर इसमें मेम्ब्रेन है, कैंट के अंदर वो दिखाई देता है साफ, उसमें शेल है ऐसा, उसके अंदर मेम्ब्रेन है. और मान लीजिए जो बॉटल्ड वाटर जो है गेस्ट हाउस से मैं भी लाया एक, तो एक इस तरह का सिस्टम से छोटा या बड़ा वो पैकेजिंग होता है. लेकिन सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट चीज है ये हम लोग नोइंगली करते हैं और अनोइंगली. कंज्यूमर्स हैव डिसाइडेड टू यूज कैंट और सच लाइक मेम्ब्रेन बेस्ड सिस्टम आइदर नोइंगली और अनोइंगली. नोइंगली, व्हाट इज नोइंगली? पता चला आपको, यू अंडरस्टूड, ये जरूरत है. लेकिन क्या अंडरस्टैंड किया आपने? जो एक्वागार्ड का जो सेल्स पर्सन आता है वो क्या निकलता है, मशीन पॉकेट से मशीन निकलता है, पानी में डालता है, बोलता है का पानी बहुत खराब है क्योंकि इसका टीडीएस ज्यादा है. टीडीएस क्या होता है?
टोटल
डिसॉल्व्ड सॉल्ट. और बारिंग्स योर सी कोस्टल एरिया एंड सम पॉकेट्स ऑफ अदर पार्ट्स, मोस्ट ऑफ द प्लेसेस को टीडीएस मिलेगा लेस देन 500. लेस देन 500 टीडीएस यू कैन ड्रिंक एज पर गवर्नमेंट रूल्स. वो बोलेगा आपका 400 है, आपका 300 है, 200 है, बहुत ज्यादा है. हम कैंट लगा दिया, देखिए आप 30 पे आ गए, 40 पे आ गए. यू आर आल्सो वेरी हैप्पी बिकॉज़ यू आर रिमूविंग समथिंग. तो 400 था और 40 हो गया, 10 टाइम्स आपका फायदा हुआ. जो चीट फंड में भी होता है 10 टाइम्स फायदा होता है पहले पहले, उसके बाद पैसा गया. लेकिन इसमें कोई ध्यान नहीं देता है, एक एक्स्ट्रा नल लगा हुआ रहता है जहां से ऑन करने से आपको पानी मिलता है लेकिन पानी बाहर नहीं जाता। तो बट कंज्यूमर्स हैव नो कंसर्न अबाउट द रिजेक्ट, उसको हम रिजेक्ट कहते हैं। तो रिजेक्ट को क्या किया जाएगा, रिजेक्ट को हम फेंक रहे हैं, दैट मींस वो ट्रीटेड वाटर जो म्यूनिसिपैलिटी गवर्नमेंट ने ट्रीट करके आपको दिया था उसका 70-80% पानी आप रिजेक्ट कर दिए। और केंट वाले ये सब आएगा आपके पास, क्योंकि ये देखिए मार्केट जो वैल्यू है कितना मार्केट है, वाटर माफिया। पानी इज ऑल्सो ए बिजनेस, वाटर इज ए बिग बिजनेस, होना ही है। सो अब देखिए ये आरओ का है, यूवी का प्यूरिफायर है, ग्रेविटी प्यूरिफायर है, जो टाटा स्वच्छ, मेरा नाम भी स्वच्छ है, स्वच्छ मजुमदार, टाटा को मालूम पड़ गया था तो ले लिया। अब ये देखिए प्रोफेसर प्रदीप ने आपको कहा कंटामिनेशन है, पेस्टिसाइड है, वो है, दिस है, ऑल लॉट्स ऑफ कंटामिनेशन विल बी देयर, फ्लोराइड है, दिस। इसमें क्या है, पेस्टिसाइड जो सब्सटेंस है दे हैव गॉट सर्टेन साइज, तो दिस इज द साइज ऑफ पेस्टिसाइड, दिस इज द साइज ऑफ सी सॉल्ट, दिस इज वायरस, दिस इज बैक्टीरिया। सेंटर में आप अगर देखेंगे तो दिस इज रिवर्स ऑस्मोसिस। मेम्ब्रेन क्या होता है, तो मैं दिखा रहा हूं आपको, मेम्ब्रेन बेसिकली सेपरेशन डिवाइस, जहां पे पोरोसिटी होता है वो प्रिंसिपल ऑफ साइज एक्सट्रूशन अप्लाई करके वो सेपरेट होता है। कॉन्टामिनेशन एक तरफ, प्यूरिफाइड वाटर इन अनदर डायरेक्शन। तो ये आरओ जो है ये सेंटर में है, मतलब सबसे छोटा है, ये इसका सबसे बड़ा एडवांटेज है, दिस इज बिगेस्ट एडवांटेज ऑफ दिस, बिकॉज वर्चुअली यू कैन ड्राइव आउट ऑलमोस्ट एवरीथिंग। डिसएडवांटेज क्या है, सिंस यू आर ड्राइविंग आउट एवरीथिंग, वहां से यू आर ड्राइविंग आउट योर एसेंशियल एलिमेंट्स, मिनरल्स और गुड थिंग्स विच यू रिक्वायर फॉर योर बॉडी। आरो तो सिलेक्टिवली आप हमारा हेल्थ के लिए जो अच्छा है उसको रिटेन करके जो खराब चीज है उसको नहीं निकल रहा है, वो निकल रहा है, सबको निकल रहा है। जैसे प्रदीप साहब ने कहा टेररिस्ट वो कुछ देखता नहीं है, कौन टेररिस्ट है, वो 10,000 पीपल सबको निकल रहा है, एयरपोर्ट में घुसने नहीं दिया। तो आपका घर में जो केंट है उसमें मेम्ब्रेन है, सो मेम्ब्रेन जो दैट इज अ सेमी परमेबल सिलेक्टिव बैरियर, सो इफ यू पुश द कंटामिनेटेड वाटर, कंटामिनेटेड पार्टिकल्स, लेट इट बी कंटामिनेटेड आर्सेनिक, क्लोराइड और व्हाटएवर इट बी, डिपेंडिंग अपॉन द पोर साइज, सेमी परमेबल मींस इट हैज गॉट पोर्स which you can see in normal light, but pores are there, so pores are so small, so bigger matter, bigger diameter matter will be arrested on the surface and water jo has smaller molecules pani wo nikal ke aata hai. So membrane, liquid membrane I am not talking about, or technical discussion mai kuch nahi kar raha, I am not going to any technical details. Polymeric membrane जो केंट के अंदर जो है वो polymeric membrane, वो आपको cloth जैसा दिखता है, it looks like a synthetic cloth, if you cut it, सफेद कलर का cloth होता है। ceramic membrane जो है उसका छोटा sample हमने लाया, ceramic membrane inorganic materials, aluminum, clay and such like material. So this is hard, this is not organic, this is inorganic. Polymeric membrane is made of organic material. उसके बाद आया सेरामिक पॉलीमर कंपोजिट, वो है सेरामिक के साथ कुछ पॉलीमर मिक्स करके सेरामिक के सरफेस के ऊपर पॉलीमर कोटिंग, स्टेबल कोटिंग डाल के वो सेपरेशन एफिशिएंसी को बढ़ाया जा सकता है। तो पहले जो मैंने दिखाया था जो ट्रीटमेंट प्लांट, रिवर वाटर प्यूरिफिकेशन प्लांट, देयर आर सो मेनी स्टेप्स, यू नीड टू हैव बैफल फिल्टर्स, sand filters, rapid sand filters, flow sand filters, coagulation, flocculation, then disinfection. There are so many units are there which is required for large water treatment plant. If you have membrane-based treatment system, you can minimize the number of steps. That is the advantage of membrane system. So this is shown here. You have some pre-treatment and then finally it goes to a membrane system. And you get the filter water for distribution. Then microfiltration, that is basically depending upon the size of your contaminants or particles, membranes are classified. Microfiltration means it is around average 0.1 micron. Ultrafiltration, you can say it is 20 nanometer in that range. Nanofiltration is below that. And reverse osmosis is in angstrom. The pore size is in the angstrom level. So this is how it works. If you push the water through this, in this membrane surface, on this membrane surface, the contaminants will be arrested and the clean material, clean water, will come with this. This is basically, you prepare tea in your house, you put on the strainer, because tea leaves are larger than the pores on the strainers. It works in the same principle. So this is why I am talking about our development, and you will understand what needs to be done in India's context. So वो हम लोगों ने lab में किया है, ये develop किया है, जो आपको piece दिखाया, small piece, but it is actually very big, 1 meter long each. उसको ऐसे shell में fit किया जाता है. That technology has been used for removal of arsenic and iron, and that is a patented technology from CGCR. तो प्रदीप साहब ने जैसे दिखाया प्लांट्स बेस्ड ऑन नैनो बेड, नैनो मटेरियल बेड, हियर आल्सो वी यूज नैनो मटेरियल एट एब्जॉर्बेंट. वो क्या होता है, आर्सेनिक पार्टिकल्स आर सो स्मॉल, नॉर्मल फिल्ट्रेशन विल नॉट बी इफेक्टिव टू रिमूव द आर्सेनिक पार्टिकल्स. व्हाट वी डू वी एड सम नैनो साइज्ड कोलॉइडल एब्जॉर्बेंट मीडिया व्हिच गेट अटैच्ड विद आर्सेनिक पार्टिकल, वो साइज becomes bigger and it is filtered. So that is the principle. So plants are installed in several places in West Bengal, Bihar. This person sells water. Water mafia, वो भी mafia बन गया. वो भी jar में sell करता है. ये हमारा कंपनी का जो फैक्ट्री है, दे आर मैन्युफैक्चरिंग दिस. सो एज ए सिस्टम वी आर सेलिंग इट थ्रू अवर लाइसेंसी. आई कैन नॉट सेल इट, बट वी हैव ट्रांसफर द टेक्नोलॉजी टू डिफरेंट कंपनीज, दे आर सेलिंग इट. सब देखिए, ये बंगाल का जो पानी है, दिस इज फ्रॉम वेस्ट बंगाल, जो ग्राउंड वाटर, इफ यू लीव द वाटर और यू कीप इट फॉर इवन 1 आवर, it becomes like this. Why? Because Professor Pradeep has shown that tube well, that base becomes red. Why? Because iron, lots of iron is there, which is in dissolved form in ferrous. We call it ferrous. अब जब पानी निकलने के तुरंत उसको दिखाई नहीं देगा, क्योंकि this is dissolved. But after some time, you from the air they get oxygen and it transforms to ferric. Ferric means it is precipitable. वो color change करके precipitable material हो जाता है और some materials are suspended also. So that's why this becomes a color like this. So membrane system से purify करने के बाद ये साफ हो जाता है. उसके बाद आप अगर देखिए इसमें एक चीज लिखा हुआ है ब्रैकिश वाटर आरओ सिस्टम. तो मेम्ब्रेन से अगर ये साफ हो जाता है सेरामिक मेम्ब्रेन से व्हाई वी आर पुटिंग ब्रैकिश वाटर आरओ. शुरू में मैंने क्या कहा था आपका अगर सैलिनिटी टीडीएस टोटल डिजॉल्व सॉलिड अगर 500 से कम है इट इज नोटोरी. यहाँ पे टीडीएस जो है 4000 है. सो रियली इट इज नॉट पॉसिबल टू ड्रिंक दैट वाटर बिकॉज वो खरास है सॉल्टी है. People are not comfortable to drink that water. So that's why you need RO system. So, RO के बिना आपको salt निकलना मुश्किल है. ये नदी का पानी हमने साफ किया. उसके बाद हमने saw plant लगाया. ये है BSF का camp है border में. If you go to border districts, तो BSF कैंप्स आर देयर अराउंड द बॉर्डर. वहाँ पे साफ पानी का बंदोबस्त नहीं है. तो गवर्नमेंट ने हम लोगों को कहा आप वहाँ पे बहुत आर्सेनिक है आयरन है यू डू इट. तो हम लोगों ने किया. ऐसा बॉर्डर का प्लान है. ये बिहार का है और ये है मालदा में. सबसे ज्यादा कैपेसिटी का है अराउंड 10 मीटर क्यूब पर. ये आप ध्यान में रखिए 10 मीटर क्यूब पर. क्यों मैं बोल रहा हूँ बाद में सब याद रखिए 10 मीटर क्यूब पर. हम लोगों ने कंपनीज को दिया है. अभी ऑल दिस प्लांट्स मैक्सिमम अप टू 10 मीटर क्यूब पावर पर आवर विथ आवर मेम्ब्रेन has been done in India. But there are many companies worldwide which are producing ceramic membranes. I am not touching about polymeric membrane and reverse osmosis because Dr. Sahi is there who is expert on RO polymeric membranes and he will discuss on RO and other things. Now you see, in India, what I said, 10 meter cube per hour with this ceramic membrane. Don't read all these things. You come to this. What is written here? 5000 meter cube per hour. So, हमारा क्या था? वो जापान का क्या है? तो कहां जापान है जहां पे बुलेट ट्रेन इज रनिंग 400 किलोमीटर पर आवर और यहां पे बुलेट ट्रेन अभी तक लगाई है. सो वही सेम थिंग वी आर 10 मीटर क्यूब पर आवर जापान है. ये तो 5000 मीटर क्यूब पर आवर. एक प्लांट है जापान में जो 23000 मीटर क्यूब पर आवर सेम सेरामिक से. क्या है उसमें? So this kind of development, engineering, manufacturing, that is available there, that expertise and industry participation and that affinity to develop the product, develop the system, upgrade the system, maximize the capacity, that attitude is there in those countries. So aap log abhi class 7-8 mein will be there. So, मेरा कहना क्या मतलब है यू फोकस ऑन दैट. जैसे इंडिया में इंडिया को कैसे मैन्युफैक्चरिंग बेस्ड बनाया जा सकता है लाइक दोस कंट्रीज. सच बिग प्लांट्स हमारा तस्वीर देखा देयर आर टू स्मॉल सेल्स एंड अदर थिंग्स बट हियर यू कैन सी नंबर ऑफ एंड लाइक दिस इट गोज ऑन. of capacity ratio, 26,500 meter cube per day. That is possible with CERN. This kind of thing in a single shell, 192 piece. Those kind of product manufacturing facilities they have established. It is true for RO, it is true for everything. Of Kent, jo keh rahe ho na, uska jo base material kahan se aata hai? Jo cloth, polymeric cloth, wo kahan se aata hai? It is imported. वहाँ से बाहर से लाके यहाँ पे सिर्फ वो बाहर का जो शेल है प्लास्टिक का वो छोटा वाला पाइप जो है वो सब जोड़ के आपको दे देता है. कैंट बोल तो मैंने क्या कहा, वहाँ पे है मैन्युफैक्चरिंग फैसिलिटी, उन लोगों ने बनाया. तो हम भी सोचा कि इधर भी हम कोशिश ना करें. तो वी आर ट्राइंग दिस इन इंडिया. तो यहाँ पे हमारा एक इंडस्ट्रियल पार्टनर है, वो है एचआर जॉनसन इंडिया, रिप्रेजेंट जॉनसन हो गया. मोस्टली आप जानते होंगे वो टाइल्स कंपनी है, जॉनसन टाइल्स आपने देखे होंगे ना. सो जॉनसन टाइल्स जो है, वी हैव टोल्ड दैट कंपनी, वी हैव कन्विंस देम दैट सेरेम मेम्ब्रेन का स्कोप है इंडिया. एक दिन हम भी 5,000 meter cube per hour बना सकते हैं प्लांट. तो हम लोगों ने इंडिया में जो मैन्युफैक्चरिंग फैसिलिटी वो हम बना रहे हैं इन द फैक्ट्री प्रमाइसेस. ये जो फैसिलिटी है, ये बिग मशीन है, यहाँ पे ये मेम्ब्रेन बनकर आएगा और उसके बाद फर्नेस में फायरिंग होके तो प्रोडक्ट, जिससे प्रोडक्ट मैन्युफैक्चरिंग फैसिलिटी जो इंडिया में था नहीं. पहले जो हम करते थे वो स्मॉल सेरामिक फैक्ट्री के पास जाके हम बोलते थे भाई हमको ये करना है, थोड़ा सा जगह दो, उनको दे देता था, ओके बनाओ ये. तो साइट, सम साइट दे उसमें कुछ पैसा लेते. तो हमें क्या होता था, साल में 200-300 ये ऐसा पीस बनता था. सो 200-300 पीस से क्या होगा, व्हाट कैन यू डू, वी नीड थाउजेंड्स. सो ये जो फैसिलिटी है हम लोगों ने बनाया है. तो ये जो फैसिलिटी है ये साल में 10,000 to 12,000 पीस मेम्ब्रेन निकल के आएगा. और प्रदीप साहब ने आपको दिखाया हाइड्रोट्रोपिक, वो सब दिखाया, वो सब साइंटिफिक टर्म्स है. लेकिन इन फ्यूचर साइंटिफिक डेवलपमेंट जो है मेम्ब्रेन में, वी कैन गो फॉर दिस डिस्टिलेशन. डिस्टिलेशन आप समझेंगे, डिस्टिलेशन मीन्स by virtue of heat you generate what, steam. First steam should be condensed to water again. So if you have the distillation, water will come out, your residual salt will be there, and if you condense it you will get pure water. So difference between RO and this will be, RO rejects salts with huge quantity of water. In membrane distillation, what will happen? You will get a solid salt, so quantity will be quite less, and in solid form, so handling will be very easy. So this kind of research is going on in all over the world. Perforation, more or less same principle. Nanofiltration, Pradeep sahab ne kaha, nanomaterial. So nanofiltration is nothing but extension of ultrafiltration, means you further reduce the pore size of the membranes to remove other contaminants which are even smaller in size. For example, pesticide, or say if you have dye molecules or such kind of molecules, your virus. So through nanofiltration you can remove those kind of contaminants. Then ceramic polymer composite membranes which can be used for forward automotive for this kind of. So this is all about membrane separation system and आपका केंट जो है वो है, आपको यूज करना है कि नहीं करना है. लेकिन मेरा कहने का ही मतलब है आप आगे जाके साइंटिस्ट बनो कि नहीं बनो, कुछ यू डू समथिंग फॉर इंडिया, जहाँ इंडिया से कुछ मैन्युफैक्चरिंग फैसिलिटी बनना चाहिए, चाहे वो गाड़ी में हो, चाहे मोबाइल में हो, चाहे लैपटॉप में हो, चाहे पानी माफिया में हो, जो भी हो, वी शुड नॉट बी अ कंज्यूमर. नाउ व्हाट वी आर कंज्यूमर, राइट? ये जो कैमरा आप देख रहे हैं ना, तो कहां से आता है कैमरा? निकॉन, कैनन, ये मोबाइल
चाइना,
जापान, कोरिया. सो एनी फील्ड ऑफ लाइफ वी आर कंज्यूमर्स, नॉट मैन्युफैक्चरर. सो मेरा मैसेज जो है, पानी का फील्ड हो और चाहे कोई भी फील्ड हो, यू ट्राई टू बिकम ए डेवलपर. डेवलपर प्लस माफिया. डेवलप करके बैठ जाने से कुछ नहीं होगा, बिकॉज बिजनेस में उसको डालना है, तभी सोसाइटी विल रन. ओके, थैंक यू.
Technologies and the membrane especially, and for being a brand ambassador for Made in India, I think you've convinced the children that they should do something for the country. Thank you again. I think we'll have one more talk and then we'll have a tea break after that, so, and then we can come back for the last talk. So our next speaker is Dr. Vinod Kumar Sahi from Central Salt and Marine Chemical Research Institute, and as you can see from the title, they are working on salt and marine chemicals. I don't know how many of you have heard this, water everywhere but not a drop to drink. Have you heard this? Yeah. So this was a poem actually, when they were sailing in the ocean, there was water everywhere but there was no drinking water. And you can understand from the talk of CSMCRI, they're going to talk about desalination technologies. Actually, where you can make the sea water or brackish water, you know, like drinking water. So Dr. Vinod Kumar Sahi is a senior scientist, principal scientist there. He's been working on electro-membrane processes, electrochemistry, and development of novel polymer composites and membranes.
I came from Gujarat. Gujarat is Bhavnagar, Gujarat, working on the water purification and desalination technology. So now I will talk to you about what technology. जैसे आपके घर में पानी की क्वालिटी क्या है और उसमें कौन सी टेक्नोलॉजी यूज करनी चाहिए और सारी किस टेक्नोलॉजी में हमने काम किया है. अगर आप ये इंडिया का मैप देखें तो ये जो ब्लू पार्ट है, यहाँ वाटर का जो टीडीएस है वो 700 से कम है, 500 से कम, मैक्सिमम 700 से कम. WHO का पहले जो था कि 500 टीडीएस तक का पानी आप पी सकते हैं, नाउ उसने रिवाइज किया 1000 टीडीएस का, लेकिन 500 टीडीएस का सेफ है. अगर पानी नहीं मिलता है, जहाँ पानी की बहुत कमी है, वहाँ 1000 टीडीएस भी में कोई खराबी नहीं है. अगर मिलता है तो यू कंसीडर 500. तो इतनी बड़े भाग में जो हमारा वाटर है, यहाँ पर बहुत टीडीएस डिजॉल्व सॉलिड नहीं है. ये ग्रीन भाग है, इसमें जो डिजॉल्व सॉलिड है अप टू 1500, मीन्स ए थोड़ा सा इसमें टीडीएस ज्यादा है यहाँ पे भी. एंड रेड है, ए ज्यादा है, पानी नमकीन लगेगा इसमें. देखिए आप गुजरात, राजस्थान और पंजाब का कुछ भाग आता है, एंड यार नियर बाई साउथ. तो अब डिफरेंट आप किस जगह रहते हैं, आपके जगह में क्या कंडीशन है. बहुत कई दो वक्ता ने मेम्ब्रेन के बारे में बोला, मेम्ब्रेन एक ने सिरेमिक मेम्ब्रेन, हम पॉलीमरिक मेम्ब्रेन के बारे में बात कर रहे हैं. मेम्ब्रेन एक फिल्टर है विद डिफरेंट पोर साइज, माइक्रो फिल्टर फिल्ट्रेशन मेम्ब्रेन. इसकी पोर साइज माइक्रोमीटर 0.08 to 5 माइक्रोमीटर में होती है, और ये जितनी बैक्टीरिया एंड सस्पेंडेड कोलाइडर पार्टिकल है उसको छान के पानी को प्योरीफाई कर देता है, Then ultrafiltration, the pore size varies between 5 to 125 nanometer, and it removes virus, bacteria, and suspended saline. Nanofiltration, this pore size is around 5 to 8 nanometer, and it removes part of biomass, virus, bacteria, suspended saline, and salt, at least 50% of the salt nanofiltration removes. Then reverse osmosis, the pore size is around 1 nanometer, less than 1 nanometer, and it removes everything from water. Every all solid, suspended solid, bacteria, virus, everything. So, अभी जो हमारा condition है, हम जो काम करते हैं, एक तरफ दरिया समुद्र है, 30,000-35,000 क्यूसीएम वहाँ का टीडीएस है, और दूसरे तरफ 400-500 हमारा ड्रिंकिंग वाटर है. एंड अल्ट्रा प्योर वाटर तक आप आइए जो इंडस्ट्री में, लेबोरेटरी में, तमाम बायोटेक्नोलॉजी में, पैथोलॉजी में, मेडिकल में यूज होता है. अल्ट्रा प्योर वाटर तक हम काम करते हैं. यू स्टार्ट फ्रॉम अल्ट्रा प्योर वाटर. दिस टेक्नोलॉजी आई विल डिस्कस द टेक्नोलॉजी. इलेक्ट्रो डीऑर्गेनाइजेशन प्रोड्यूसिंग हाई रेजिस्टिव अल्ट्रा प्योर वाटर. अगर आपके घर का पानी का टीडीएस 400-700 किलोवाट है, देन यू यूज हालो फाइबर टेक्नोलॉजी और अल्ट्रा फिल्ट्रेशन टेक्नोलॉजी और सिरेमिक मेम्ब्रेन, व्हाट एवर इज देयर हियर. मैं बताऊंगा अलग अलग कि क्या उसमें फायदा है. देन अगर 1500 तक है, देन इट इज रिकमेंडेड टू यूज द नैनो फिल्ट्रेशन टेक्नोलॉजी, नॉट आरओ. इन मार्केट इफ यू गो, सब आके आरओ लगा देते हैं. दिस इज नॉट नेसेसरी. इफ अगर टीडीएस 1500 से 10,000 तक है, ज्यादा बढ़ता है, देन देयर इज टू टाइप आरओ. एक लो रिजेक्शन, एक हाई रिजेक्शन. 1500, 2000, 2500 है तो लो रिजेक्शन का आरओ यूज करिए. 10,000, 5,000, 7,000 है तो हाई रिजेक्शन का आरओ यूज करिए. ये चाइना का जो माल है उसमें नहीं मिलता है, बट आवर इंडियन इट देयर. हमने ये डेवलप किया है एंड कंपनियों को ट्रांसफर किया है, मार्केट में अवेलेबल है. देन दरिया के किनारे जाइए, सी वाटर डिसैलिनेशन. दिस इज टफ जॉब क्योंकि हमको 32,000 तो वी हैव टू ब्रिंग लेस देन 500. But it is necessary because we are in the process of installing several lakh liter plant in the naval base, Jamnagar and everywhere. Coastal land में जाएंगे तो वहाँ ग्राउंड वाटर भी 20,000-25,000 सी वाटर के बराबर है, तो they can't drink water. तो this is the technological profile. So our work includes all the things. Now I came to hollow fiber. Hollow fiber, we are making the polymeric hollow fiber, and there is pore of 1 micron, thin pore is there, and this is the view of hollow fiber. This is the making of hollow fiber, and usko bandh ke we are making the hollow fiber module. It is our technology has been transferred to the party, and this is a commercial module. The beautifulness of the, अगर आपके घर का, जैसे आप दिल्ली में रहते हैं, 700 से ज्यादा टीडीएस होगा नहीं, तो इसमें बैक्टीरिया, वायरस, सब रिडक्शन है. वाटर फ्लक्स वेरी हाई है. सबसे जो अच्छा चीज है ये मॉड्यूल है, हॉलो फाइबर मेकिंग मशीन है. दिस इज द व्यू ऑफ हॉलो फाइबर एंड दिस इज द पिक्चर ऑफ द थिंग. एंड इसमें वाटर का नुकसान नहीं होता है. 95-98% वाटर वॉज यू कैन यूज. देर इज नो वेस्टेज ऑफ वाटर. एंड इसमें कुछ पंप हाई प्रेशर की भी जरूरत नहीं है. इट इज वेरी इजी टेक्निक. ये आप कलम लगाएंगे यू विल गेट प्योर वाटर बाई हाइड्रो स्मॉल हाइड्रोस्टेटिक प्रेशर. दिस इज द स्पिनिंग ऑफ द हॉलो फाइबर आर एंड दिस इज द आवर लाइसेंसी booklet what hollow fiber is market company is Uniflex Membrane Limited Pune. So they are selling the module. आप अपने घर के लाइन में चौले मॉड्यूल लगा देंगे it will purify your water. No need to do anything. Then ultra filtration thin film. Hollow fiber is less than the pore size of micrometer. Ultra filtration is little bit high, thin film. It is in 10 to power minus 6. We are casting the ultra filtration membrane. This is a membrane rate. This is a casting machine. It is controlled by total, controlled by speed and thickness, everything. Controlled by the computer. The technology, we developed this. The base is polyester porous film and then polypropylene thin film we are casting. And if we are able to fabricate big plant of 1 lakh liter per day, 10,000 LPS like that, it depends upon the need. And even 20 liter LPS domestic application, then it depends upon the thing. It is very good for 700, 800. Water recovery is 95%. And this also can be used for the treatment of industrial water or pre-treatment of the industrial water. So it serves membrane technology, one side serves for drinking water and one side serves for the water conservation or waste water treatment so that we can recycle the water. The production cost of the membrane is 140 to 160 rupees per meter square, and the cost means if you need a domestic unit, it may be 2 to 3 meter square membrane will be sufficient in small size module, in big size module, and we can pack up to very big module. This is the nano filtration module. As I told, if your water TDS is going 700 to 1500, then WHO calculates you should drink the water approximately 500 ppm, and if it is 1200, 1300, in nano filtration, you are removing all the bacteria, virus, everything, biomass, and salt at least 45 to 50% salt is also being removed because pore size is around 5 to 8 nanometer, very small pore size, is removed the salt also. And this also gives very good flux, and since flux is very high, then water rejection will be very low, and at least 85% water you can recover. Generally, if you go in domestic, at least 60 to 70% water is going to waste in drain. So that is also a problem, how much water you are sending into drain. So here, you can, and this technology, 40-40 module is 360 to 40, 420 LPS capacity at 150 PSI. Pressure. So this is commercial module produced at our licensee. This is from our lab. Licensee is also producing and it is available in the market. Now I am coming on reverse osmosis membrane. Reverse osmosis membrane, screening salt from the water is very difficult because the molecular size of the salt and the water is in angstrom level. So it is very difficult. So what we are doing, we are making thin film composite membrane. As I told you, first we made the ultra filtration membrane, then Further, we are making one top layer on the membrane by interfacial polymerization, and that is working as a screening layer and separating the salt and water. You can see here, this is the base polymer, polyester. This is the polysulfone, and this around ultra thin 200 nanometer layer of polyamide, graphene polyamide membrane, and this is the view of TFT membrane. Worldwide, thin composite RO membrane is available, and our membrane is also commercialized. This is the membrane making unit. This is the surface coating, and this is the view of spiral, how we are wrapping the membrane in a spiral wound so that you can make the spiral. And this is the view of module. This module, I think this is 90 to 92% ochelega, but seawater may not less than 99%. Then you can read from 30,000 to 300. 1% will be 3%, 300 ppm. So that is, it is going beyond the rejection, 95, 95 to upar jane mein bahut problem hota hai. You need very huge pressure, and seawater concentration is very high. Then we need at least 700 to 800 psi to good optimize the pressure on the seawater membrane. ये सब अल्ट्रा TFT मेम्ब्रेन भी चार कंपनियों के कमर्शियलाइज है, एंड दे आर सी वाटर मेम्ब्रेन इज नॉट कमर्शियलाइज. सी वाटर अर्लियर वी वेर गोइंग इन टू फेज, ब्रिंगिंग 30,000 to 15,000, एंड देन अंदर फेज 15,000 to less than 500. बट नाउ वी आर एबल टू डेवलप मेम्ब्रेन विद 99% रिजेक्शन. So in one phase, one step, we are able to achieve the drinking water. Only the thing is, the water recovery is 30 to 35%. In that case, there is no problem because seawater membrane is operating nearby sea. So there is no problem. You can drain the waste in the sea, and salt equilibrium will be there. Now, brackish water desalination. What I am talking, जो 1500 ppm के वाटर ज्यादा में रहते हैं, वो ब्रेकिश वाटर है. यहाँ पर 3000 लिखे हैं, लेकिन 1500, बिकॉज जनरल इफ यू गो 1500 to 2000 बहुत ज्यादा कंसंट्रेशन है. वहाँ पर भी इफ नैनो फिल्ट्रेशन डिडंट वर्क, देन लो रिजेक्शन आरो. British water you can consider low reaction water, RO, and water recovery in 65%. We have the capacity, one unit 500 to 10,000 LPR, and this cost will be, water cost will be 7 paisa per liter. And sea water rejection, we have the capacity, water recovery is 20 to 25%, and the water cost will be 12 to 15 paisa per liter. So this technology is available, and one can use for the water filtration. Our country is very diversified. Everywhere we can see some natural calamity here and there. And first, if there is flood or cyclone, the drinking water problem is very serious. Water mafia, as he told Dr. Majumdar, to build up it. So we have developed, this is the installation of different RO plant in different part of India. We have developed the mobile RO bus, and this bus is going and providing drinking water टू 10,000 कैल्पियस, एक घंटे में 10,000 लीटर। तो लोग वहाँ के जो अफेक्टेड है वो बकेट में अपना कंटेनर में भर के पीने का पानी काम करते हैं। द बस इज वेरी बिग नाउ वी आर वर्किंग। लास्ट ईयर वी इंस्पायर्ड आवर पीएम विजिटेड इजराइल एंड ही ड्रोव वन जीप टाइप व्हीकल माउंटेड बाई आरो। Then also we talk to several automobile companies, but the engine should be very powerful. So we are developing an Isuzu vehicle. It is a small vehicle so that it can rapidly go in small and narrow space, because movement of bus is little bit restricted. The small vehicle can go anywhere. So to some 2-3 vehicle we are also developing. And I think it is in final state, within 2-3 months it will be ready. So because recently the bus was in Kerala and Odisha, there was calamity. There was heavy rain in Rajasthan, but it stopped. We made ready ki now we are crossing Rajasthan. So this is there. We are taking the society care. Societal work is also going on, because drinking water in village and they can't afford purchasing of drinking water. Work on arsenic and fluoride removal. I think Dr. Pradeep developed a very good material for the arsenic replacement. Our aiming is also very good. We are also having the same type of concept. First, we are making the arsenic by coagulation, then by resin, and by ultra filtration. It removes this output. It depends upon the resin volume, how much resin we are putting in the column. So we can have a very big resin column, very small resin column, and we installed several plants was installed in the in the process to arsenic affected area in Bengal and Bihar. And this is the 250 LPS, and this is the small column for domestic use, 25 LPS. And we developed a technology. If there is a light paper chromatography, you put the paper and by color you can guess what is the arsenic contamination, because it is very useful for the vendor to know ki there is arsenic level, what is the arsenic level in our drinking water. If the paper gives color, changing color, like chromatography. Now, as I told, our institute is working on the all spectrum of membrane science and technology. Till time, I was speaking on the pressure-driven membrane technology. लेकिन बिजली प्रेशर ग्रेडियंट है, तो बिजली भी ग्रेडियंट होता है, इलेक्ट्रिकल इज आल्सो ए ग्रेडियंट। तो नाउ आई एम टॉकिंग ऑन द इलेक्ट्रिकल ग्रेडियंट एंड दिस उसको आयन एसिड मेम्ब्रेन हम कहते हैं। आयन एसिड मेम्ब्रेन हमने डेवलप किया, दिस इज द मेकिंग प्रोसेस ऑफ द आयन एसिड मेम्ब्रेन। बेसिकली इट इज सल्फोनेटेड एंड brominated and aminated membrane. Earlier it was doing chloromethylation by fluorocarb, but the chloromethyl is such a bank, then we invented a new pathway, bromination and then quaternization. Our membrane is very good, and this we compare our membrane with the international membrane. What? This Asahi, Tokuyama, Nebian, New septa. So you can see the property is comparable. And our mindset is Japan ka hai to bahut acha hai, hamara hai to nahi acha hai. This mindset, I'm not advocating don't compromise on the quality. But if quality is same, then prefer indigenous Indian market, Indian product. So you can compare it. This is the electrodynamics. अभी क्या है कि अभी कैटायन एसिड मेम्ब्रेन कैटायन को निकालता है, एनायन एसिड मेम्ब्रेन एनायन को निकालता है। सपोज यहाँ साल्ट है तो इधर अल्टरनेट कंपार्टमेंट में चला जाएगा तो कंपार्टमेंट प्यूरिफाई डिसलेक्ट हो जाएगा. बेस्ड ऑन द प्रिंसिपल वी डेवलप द इलेक्ट्रोडायलिसिस यूनिट एंड दिस इज यूज फॉर दिस इज ऑल्सो यूज फॉर द वाटर डिसलिनेशन. द ब्यूटिनेशन ऑफ द यूनिट इन आर ओ सपोज योर रिजेक्शन इज वेरी हाई and your feed water quality is 2000, then you will get only 200 ppm. This is not good. 200 ppm and 100 ppm water is not good for the drinking. So I think there should be cut off. 500 is very good. And this is the thing. This unit, there is a village 50 km away from Bhavnagar. Nearby port, there is a village. वहाँ पे 75% रेजिडेंट स्टोन से पीड़ित थे. 75% उस गांव के द सरपंच कॉन्टेक्टेड वी इंस्टॉल ए प्लांट एंड पावर भी कोई नहीं देना था. नो बडी वॉन्ट टू गिव द पावर. देन वी अडॉप्टेड सोलर पावर इलेक्ट्रोडायलिसिस एंड प्लांट. दिस इज अराउंड 400 एचपी प्लांट. The TDS, the groundwater TDS is 4,000 to 5,000. And I satisfied when very old lady, she got the drinking water nearby her house. So this, and this unit is going on since 2.5 years. There is no problem. And there is no attendant also. A builder is putting the, this only filling the over tank. This for filling the this over time and this hydrostatic pressure we are using to flow across the membrane. So only filling the over time you need this pump and only hydrostatic pump is doing everything. And this is the in tank water is collected and people is taking water. Jitna jisko zarurat hai le gaya. This is some other application. So around 500 sodium, 30 to 60 ppm magnesium, 40 to 60 calcium, potassium, chloride, sulfate, carbonate, all the things. Other micronutrients, very PPB level, that's why it is not included. There are lot of micronutrients, but what is major nutrient, I am including that. Produce nutritious alkaline water. Now, abhi aapne सुना होगा कि पेट में एसिडिटी है तो चूरन खाने का. अभी मार्केट में जाइए तो एल्कलाइन वाटर, वो वाटर को ये थोड़ा बढ़ा दीजिए 7.8 वो बिग बिग वो विराट कोहली साहब पीते हैं वहाँ जर्मनी का यूरोप का पानी. दैट इज ओनली एल्कलाइन वाटर. मिनरल बैलेंस एल्कलाइन वाटर. व्हाट एल्स यू कैन नेम इन द वाटर. So here, by electricity, we have facility to split the water. We are going slight overlimiting region. So in cathode compartment, cathode chamber, there is slight electrode, slight water is fitting to producing hydroxide ion. And that hydroxide ion, we are taking use of a TDS controller. I will tell you very soon. So this is the thing. You can tune the alkalinity or a the gas or acidity or ऐसा है ना जो सोडा पीते थे पहले सोडा हवा सोडा सोडा पानी पीते थे वो उसका काम करेगा. This is as I promised ultra pure water. This is our EDI unit based on the EDI principle electrodeionization. Now you see the market. Our unit cost this 15 liter, we develop 15 and 50 liter, this 50 liter, 15 liter, we are, since 2 years, we are testing, one side there is a mini core unit, one side there is our unit, feed is there, performance is there, mini core cost is around 15 liter, it is around 10 liter, and our production cost is around 50,000. So this is also, negotiation is going on to and 400 crore का बिजनेस मिनीपुर का इट इज पर एनम इन इंडिया में 400 crore एंड आवर टेक्नोलॉजी इज रेडी ओनली एज ए रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट वी कैन डू वेरी गुड फिनिशिंग एंड गुड एथिक एवरीथिंग बट ए कंपनी वाला कर लेगा हमने तो साइंस किया वी डिड साइंस तो दैट वेरी ग्रेट रिजल्ट इज बिलो द साइंस डू द हाई साइंस एंड it will solve the problem with this world. In conclusion, CSIR has provided permanent membrane-based water purification desalination technology for our whole spectrum. And I should be thankful to the CSIR and Director General and Madam Gita for providing me the time to speak and our director because he is my mentor and providing everything. Okay.
Telling the cost advantage of the technologies we have developed. So we'll have a short tea break. We'll be back by 4:30. And the students can sit here. We will give you the snack boxes. And if you want to take a small break, you can go out. And the rest of us can have tea outside. We'll be back by 4:30. The environmental engineering. And he's worked a lot on various technologies for cleaning and recycling of domestic and industrial waste.
No tea to receive now.
So now that we have had tea and you know, good stuff to eat, so we'll have this session where we will discuss the final outcome or something which has happened in this space. So before my colleague Dr. Pawan speaks, he is an expert in this field. I just want to review, general outline. Beginning में थोड़ा मैं हिंदी में बोल लेता हूँ. सुबह जो अभी आप अपने घर से भी निकले होंगे, बहुत लोगों के घर में फिल्टर है, किसी के घर में different varieties के फिल्टर्स हैं, है ना? लेकिन कितने लोगों को गांव में फिल्टर? हमारी कितनी population जो है वो गांव में रहती है? तो अगर आप ये कैलकुलेशन ध्यान से देखना शुरू करोगे तो आपको लगेगा कि शहरों में भी कम से कम 80% लोग ऐसे हैं जिनके घरों में फिल्टर नहीं है और अफोर्ड नहीं कर सकते. उनके पास पैसे नहीं है कि फिल्ट्रेशन के लिए इतना पैसा खर्च करें. और गांव में तो पक्का नहीं है. अब धीरे धीरे गाँव में तो जो थोड़े अमीर हैं वो सचिन तेंदुलकर वाला या हेमा मालिनी वाला खरीद रहे हैं. लेकिन अगर आप देखोगे पानी की जो समस्या है वो टेक्नोलॉजी की समस्या एक हद तक है. उसके बाद ये हद जो है ख़त्म हो जाती है कि हमारे पास तो पैसे नहीं हैं. तो पानी की समस्या को अगर हल करना है तो हम लोग को पहले ये देखना पड़ेगा कि पहले जो हमें नल में पानी आता था उसको हम लोग पीते थे तो कितने लोग बीमार पड़ते थे. और अभी जो हम लोग है ना बढ़िया कैंट वाला जो पी रहे हैं या दूसरा वाला जो पी रहे हैं उससे हम लोग कितने हेल्दी हैं. यहाँ भी आपने देखा होगा कि हम लोगों ने CSIR में अभी पूरा बॉटल वाटर बंद कर दिया है. इसका मतलब ये नहीं है कि हम लोग अनहेल्दी पानी पी रहे हैं. हम लोग सिर्फ ये चेक कर रहे हैं कि हमारा पानी जो हमारे यहाँ आता है वो अच्छा आता है एंड इट इज़ अ गुड क्वालिटी एंड व्हेन वी ड्रिंक वी आर ऑल राइट. सो इफ यू कंपेयर एंड विच इज व्हाट वी डू कि वी कंपेयर आवरसेल्फ विद मेनी अदर कंट्रीज. दूसरे कंट्रीज में आप कभी भी जाते हो तो वहाँ पे टैप से ही पानी पीते हैं. बॉटल का पानी बहुत कम खरीदते हैं. कभी कभी यहाँ कहीं जाना हो तो खरीदते हैं. और हमारा देश जो इस चीज़ को मतलब पैसे की इतनी कमी है जो इस चीज़ को बर्दाश्त नहीं कर सकता है उसको फोर्स किया जा रहा है कि आप जो है टेक्नोलॉजी का इस्तेमाल कीजिए भले आपका पानी साफ हो या नहीं हो. बहुत बार हमें पता ही नहीं होता कि हमें ज़रूरत भी है कि नहीं है. तो इस चीज़ के ऊपर हमारे जो कलीग हैं डॉक्टर पवन बात करेंगे कि अगर इंडिया को अपने वाटर अपने पानी के बारे में समस्या हल करनी है तो पहले ये देखना पड़ेगा कि 70-80% लोग जो हैं उनको सेफ वाटर कैसे दिया जा सके बिना इस तरह के डिवाइसेस के जो बहुत एक्सपेंसिव हैं. और अगर डिवाइसेस यूज़ करने हैं तो कहाँ यूज़ करने चाहिए कि हमें जानकारी होनी चाहिए कि किस पानी के साथ. साही जी ने बताया कि किस पानी की अवस्था किस सिचुएशन में होनी चाहिए जब हमने वो डिवाइसेस यूज़ करें और उसकी क्या टेक्नोलॉजी होनी चाहिए उसको कैसे हम प्रोपेगेट करें. हाउ डू वी गो इन द मार्केट व्हेन वी गो इन द मार्केट हु टेल्स यू हु लेट्स यू इट्स अ बिग प्रॉब्लम. सो व्हेन यू गो इन द मार्केट टू बाय एनी वाटर प्यूरीफायर they will actually sell you what they want to sell. They will never ask you कि आपका पानी कैसा आ रहा है तो मैं आपको सजेस्ट करूँगा कौन सा आपके लिए सुटेबल है. वो नहीं होता. उनको मालूम है कि ये चीज़ तुमको बेचना ही है और आज ये आ गए हैं तुमको हम आर ओ वाला दे दें या फिर कुछ और दे दें यूविक का दे दें या डिस फिल्टर वाला दे दें वॉट एवर. सो द होल कॉन्वर्सेशन हमारी जो इस आज आफ्टरनून में हमारा डिस्कशन चालू हुआ था कि वाटर टेक्नोलॉजी और नो टेक्नोलॉजी, वी शुड बी गेटिंग सेफ वाटर, एंड टू गेट सेफ वाटर देर आर मेनी अदर ऑप्शंस. टेक्नोलॉजी इज नॉट द ओनली ऑप्शन, और मे बी इट्स अ कॉम्बिनेशन ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी एंड द प्रोसेस एंड आवर बिहेवियर. द वे वी यूज इट, वी विल बी एबल टू गेट सेफ वाटर इन आवर हाउसेस. ओके, सो प्लीज एंजॉय डॉक्टर पवन्स लेक्चर ऑन दिस. थैंक यू.
Thank you, Dr. Rakesh Kumar. Welcome Dr. Pawan from NEDI again, a senior scientist. He's worked a lot on water resource management, and he was actually on the panel of the National Green Tribunal along with other experts who come out with the guidelines for the water purification. So we will hear from him what made NGT to accept these guidelines and what was the scientific reasoning for it.
Which I already been talked by my colleague Dr. Shahi, what are the concerns of different stakeholders, particularly industries, policy makers, or even citizens like you. What is the status of water system in our country, or for that matter, what is happening is when we use this point of use water treatment system, how good and bad the water quality is, what are the futuristic requirements for water technologies based on the NGT order which has been recently released, and the way forward. So, I tried to summarize these major issues related to membrane, particularly RO-based systems. One is installation without considering raw water quality. So, this has been told by Dr. Shahi and other speakers also. If we have safe water, only TDS is an issue, your water is bacterially contaminated, usme kuch yadi pathogens hai, to hum kaun si technology use kar sakte hain? एक मेजर इशू है. व्हाट आर द डेफिशिएंसीज ऑफ मिनरल इन ट्रीटेड वाटर. इट हैज बीन टॉक्ड अबाउट दैट व्हेन वी ट्रीट वाटर थ्रू आरओ सम ऑफ दीज सॉल्ट्स गेट रिड्यूस्ड. थर्ड इशू इज क्वांटिटी एंड अनलिमिटेड डिस्पोजल रिजेक्ट वाटर. वी आर टॉकिंग दैट द रिजेक्ट वाटर व्हिच गेट्स जनरेटेड थ्रू आरओ सिस्टम इज समटाइम्स एज हाई एज 70%, 60%, 50%. It means that we waste that much of water. Fourth and last point is waste management, such as disposal of used membrane and cartridges. What happens once the cartridge is over or your membrane is fouled? What should we do with this? So these are the four concerns related to RO systems. But there are concerns of stakeholders also. I feel that stakeholders include industry, policy makers, particularly in state, and citizens like you. It has been claimed that technology removes all the contaminants because Dr. Swachha has shown the pore size in membrane is very small, so that all the contaminants, all the particles, the salts can be rejected. No alternative water treatment technology is considered while installing this plant because people are not aware that what is good for you, what sort of treatment system should be adopted. Underdeveloped monitoring mechanism. In India, unfortunately, we don't have very, very robust monitoring system. Once we install treatment plant in village, nobody goes there and then finds out what is happening to it, which is related to, say, these policymakers sitting in state. There's ambiguous statutory regime in India. There's market competitiveness. Once we start advertising one particular system, we start following that. And then largely people, a common mass, is unaware of various treatment technologies. What is status of RO system? So we have done a study in Maharashtra for UNICEF and Water and Sanitation Department, and we have chosen 21 locations in four districts, Yavatmal, Chandrapur, Bid and Usmanabad. These are four districts located in Maharashtra. So these are the location in Chandrapur and Yavatmal, and these are say 13 locations in Bid and Usmanabad, where big 1000 liter per hour water ATMs, you might have heard even water ATM and RO based plants are installed. So how do these villages get water from this water ATM or RO system? So they have like bore well from where the water is pumped out and say filled in this raw water tank from where it is pre-treated using some pre-filtration which can be say activated carbon filter, from where it is put to reverse osmosis, and then UV treatment is also imparted and the treated water is collected, and then this is the water dispenser in which you can use even card so that the water can be dispensed. So this is the simple system which is installed in our house. Also we have got a similar system except this water dispenser. What we have found out of 29 plants had TDS less than 500 mg per liter. So they have not even analyzed water quality, how much is the water TDS. No other plant had raw water TDS about 2000 mg per liter. So in our friend from BIS is here and he knows that the allowable limit is 2000 mg per liter. Fluoride in all these 21 locations was less than 1 mg per liter. So there was no need to remove fluoride using this RO system. Bacterial contamination was also observed. So, but despite not having fluoride and nitrate and then having say TDS less than 500 mg per liter, people have gone only for RO system. So what are our findings? So they have installed many plants, and when we visited these plants, only 57% of the plants are operational. Baki sare band ho chuke hain kyunki paise bhi mil rahe hain jo bhi. Out of all these plants visited and 9 locations, water quality complied with this. It means that we found out that treated water doesn't meet even the base requirement. Outlet TDS was less than 100 mg per liter. When we treat water, when we remove water, this salt, we have found out that TDS in majority of the plants was less than 100 mg per liter. Average efficiency of the plant was 33%. It means that we were rejecting 67% of water. Only 33% of the water was utilized by these villages that treated. No reject was observed. And what they were doing, actually they were putting this water, reject water, into nearby wells. And we have tested even reject water quality in 2-3 locations. We have found out the reject water quality is less than 500 mg per liter without any other contaminant. So it could have also been drunk. No repair and maintenance in any of the plant, because these contractors have been given money only to install plants. And the arrangement was that the people will pay for operation maintenance. The people were not paying, so these contractors were not maintaining these plants properly. And then willingness to pay for RO treated drinking water was very less. So we really think that this plant may not be sustainable. These are say 2-3 year old plants. We have done another study in July 2019, and then in Nagpur, and we found out that okay, when the raw water is zero, means there should not be any E. coli or bacteria in our drinking water. In Nagpur, we found in some households that there's hardly any, say, E. coli. In some houses, we found out the E. coli or fecal coliforms are as high as 34 or 602. And then they had this RO system in place, but this RO system could not bring down bacterial level from 602 to 0, which is drinking water standard. And some places we have found out the treated water has more total coliform than raw water. It means that they are not properly maintaining these systems, and then this RO system which is there in household is breeding ground for bacteria. So we have to be very cautious when we use this point of use water treatment system, our RO system in our household, that we should periodically, at least once in 6 months, we should get it properly, maintained. We should ask these people to come, a mechanic to come, and then clean it properly. Secondly, we have also studied what is happening to other treatment systems. And here also the situation was more or less same. We have collected water samples, raw water sample, we have collected treated water sample, and we have found out the treated water also has bacterial contamination. So do you feel that we should use this point of use water treatment system without proper maintenance? We should not. So we should be very careful when we use these systems in a household. So what is the futuristic requirements I am talking about now, particularly RO system? So this is the NGT order based on the committee set up by NGT. They concentrated on these 4 issues. Deployment of RO system based on water quality, deficiency of minerals caused by RO processes which have been talked, provision in RO system, how the display of TDA should be there. And last was the waste management, means RO reject water management, how much should be the efficiency of RO system, and how these cartridges are spent membranes or used membranes should be dealt with. So first recommendation by entity was that up to 500 mg per liter TDS with input waterability not having any other contaminant, we should not use RO. So this is the cutoff limit which they have imposed. If it is more than 500 mg per liter of TDS, then the reject should be 40%, or you should get at least 60% of water. It has already been told that if we treat water through RO, these salts get removed. But that was recommended, and it has been now made mandatory that RO system shall maintain a minimum TDS of 150 mg per liter. You might have seen advertisement also. They advertise that they have some demineralization unit. They have some system in place so that they can maintain 150 mg per liter. So you need to ensure that your system has treated water quality having TDS up to 150 mg per liter. And this is based on one FSSI proposed calcium and magnesium standard also, which recommends that we should have even minimum level of calcium and magnesium. Our Bureau of Indian Standard, even WHO also at the moment don't recommend any minimum level of calcium and magnesium. But these are some essential elements of, and FSSI have proposed some standard for maintaining calcium and magnesium at this range. So NGT has recommended, once this is notified by FSSI, RO manufacturer need to have this much minimum of calcium and magnesium in treated RO water. What is use and disposal of RO reject water? Recovery of water should be more than 60%. Further provision should be laid down to improve the recovery up to 75%. And industry fortunately expect that they can achieve this standard. And use of RO reject water not having TDS of 2100 mg per liter can be used for various other non-potable purposes. So these are the recommendations of NGT for using RO reject water. What should we join for RO membrane system? And then it has been recommended that the RO membrane should be dealt by using this plastic waste management rules 2016. So there is a notification available through which this waste should be maintained. And one more thing which had happened is that these all the RO units which are at your home should be geotagged. I mean, there should be record of all the RO systems. Once you are, say, disposing of these spent or exhausted RO cartridges, there should be record. It should be properly disposed of. So suppose we have like 10 lakhs of RO system in India, we should have record of all these systems. Once we are replacing these cartridges, record of all these 10 lakh systems should be available to us. There are other recommendations, and I'll only read about this. The concerned local body like public health engineering department or municipal corporation which are responsible to water supply should inform consumers that how much, what is the water quality. So through billing instrument, they can inform consumers so that they can appropriately choose this water treatment system. And then they are also promoting some star rating of water system in countries like China. They have developed some star rating, and then they give this grading as we give an air conditioner so that people can choose appropriate type of RO system where the reject is low. The way forward we feel is we have to implement water quality based treatment system, and then I feel that industry, academic institutions, agencies like BIS should work together. So develop some statutory requirements. I think BIS should come forward, and then we also recommended there is a standard available for RO system which should be made mandatory so that these industries follow these standards. We have to scientifically address issues of water treatment, particularly reject water system. And then fortunately CSIR is working on improving reject management treatment. We have to also make alternate technologies, and that these technologies should be made more competitive. Now we are giving emphasis only on RO system. How can we say how nanotechnology in place? How can we have like ceramic membranes in place so that people are aware of it and that they can have say these technologies at lower cost? We have to also improve monitoring mechanism. You have seen my presentation in Maharashtra, we have seen that these treatment plants based on RO don't even work properly. So we have to improve the system so that these plants work well. We have to harness citizen science and make consumers aware of various treatment systems available in the market. And then we have to improve water quality, which is supplied in various municipalities. They are also particularly needy. We don't use any, say, point of use water treatment system. We use water directly because we ensure that water is supplied to needy is safe. So these are way forward, which we are looking forward to, say, monitor point of use water treatment system, including RO in India. So thanks a lot.
Of these guidelines and how it is really going to impact the way we use RO. And I think the point you mentioned about citizen science, I think this is the first experiment where we have students listening to it, and hopefully they will influence their families, and when they make a water filter choice in their homes, hopefully they get the message. So I think we've done with the talks. Now we can have a kind of a panel discussion and questions. So I request all the speakers to come onto the stage. And also I request Dr. Hassan Javed Khan, who is the editor of Science Reporter and who's the chief scientist at ESK, to moderate the panel discussion and the questions.
Good evening, everyone. I think we've had a wonderful afternoon session listening to all the talks by Professor Pradeep, Dr. Swatch, and others. The groundwork for this panel discussion has already been wonderfully laid down by Dr. Rakesh Kumar and Dr. Pawan. The thrust for this panel discussion is going to be, is RO system a necessity in all conditions, or can we do away with it? And Dr. Pawan has laid down some groundwork for this. He's laid down how he was a part of the NGT panel that has submitted guidelines to the government. Basically, just to outline some of the guidelines that NGT has given, I'll briefly outline them. NGT guidelines call for the government to issue directions to manufacturers to ban water purifiers where the TDS in water is below 500 mg per liter. One point the NGT guidelines speak about is sensitizing public about the need for or the ill effects of demineralized water, as we have just listened from Dr. Pawan. RO systems take away all the minerals. So the ill effects of demineralized water, the public needs to be sensitized about this. Thirdly, make it mandatory for companies to tweak their systems, their RO systems, so that they can recover more than 60% of the water that is rejected at present. Manufacturers also need to provide proper labeling on their RO devices. So these are basically the four main guidelines that have been issued by NGT to government. We have already met our four speakers. We have two new members on the panel. Mr. P. Rajesh from the Bureau of Indian Standards, and Dr. V. A. Raju from the Water Quality India Association. And we welcome them both on the panel. So now I'll straight away open the floor to the audience. And you can start asking questions, especially young children here. I hope you have been listening closely and have made out some questions. Yeah?
जैसे बच्चे ने पूछा हालो फाइबर हार्मफुल कैसे है, हालो फाइबर हार्मफुल नहीं है, टीडीएस कम होता है, 500 से कम है, उसमें वाटर में अभी बहुत बायोमास बैक्टीरिया वायरस ये सब ज्यादा है, तो उनको रिमूव करने के लिए नहीं तो वाटर बांध डिजीज बहुत ज्यादा होते हैं, 80% डिजीज वाटर बांध एंड ये स्प्रेड होते हैं बायोलॉजिकल बायोमास, तो इसको रिमूव करने के लिए हालो फाइबर या अल्ट्रा फिल्ट्रेशन जरूरी है, या अगर वाटर में ये सब बायोमास नहीं है देन इसकी प्रयोग कोई इसकी कोई लेकिन ये चेक होना चाहिए कि इसमें कोई पैथोजेनिक बैक्टीरिया वायरस तो नहीं है, कि जैसे बिहार में यूपी में जो भी बच्चों का बुखार होता है ना उसका मेन रीजन वाटर है.
Okay, possibly system. Now we are working on polysulfur material also, which can be used as a purification system. And the kind of filter we already have, ceramic filters we already have, because they are cheaper alternatives.
Fine. Thank
you. UV standard we have. Okay. That is quite popular at the ISMR. Now we have also granted license for this RO unit, under IS-16240. And we hope, since at present it is voluntary, by talking to the ministry, maybe if we make it mandatory, customer will get probably more value for money. Thank you.
Yeah, any other question? Yeah.
My name is Abdaga from Navoday Vidyalaya. My question goes to Professor Deep Pradeep. I want to ask a question on the arsenic filter installed in school. What is the way of disposal of arsenic containing filter in the column you read, you use?
Anything more? Arsenic is an element, as you know, and you cannot degrade it. You cannot break it like pesticides, you cannot break it. So ultimately, arsenic goes back to the soil. And the question is, where do you want to take that soil, you know, arsenic to? Let us say, if you remove that arsenic that is coming from the local soil, I am of the belief that that should go back to the same soil. It is not that your arsenic that I take you to Chennai or somewhere from Chennai is arsenic you bring it to Bengal. That shouldn't happen. So the technology is just that. Now question is that, does it recontaminate the water? So the whole idea is that when arsenic is taken up by a material, whichever material it is, it should not, if you put back into the soil, it should not release more arsenic at a faster rate. Eventually it will go, but not at a faster rate, so that it, boom, it comes out like 1000 ppm concentration. So there is a release rate for which we have established something called TCLP, toxicity leaching protocols. So using these protocols, we establish whether a material is good to be as safe disposal is possible or not. Once this qualifies that, only then such material can use. So eventually we ensure that the material can go back to the field. This is the whole principle. Now, is there any high value material that you can make out of arsenic? CGCR, I look at this kind of thing. But ultimately, arsenic people thought long ago that gallium arsenide is a new material. It can substitute silicon. But gallium arsenic technology did not evolve. So it is not good to keep arsenic in our backyard. So therefore, we have decided that it should go back. Now, there are other uses of arsenic which are not really adding a great value, like rodenticide and all that, which is not adding great value. This is the summary substance. Okay? Thank you.
Yeah, next question.
My name is Himanshu and I am from JNU Ghaziabad. Good evening to all of you. My question goes to Dr. Pradeep that he has talked about the nanotechnology and it is very effective in removing the arsenic from the water at very high extent. Sir, I want to ask you that, can it remove other harmful substances like rust from the water? That is usually found in the hand pump water and we all know that rust is mostly cancerogenic. So can it remove the rust from the water?
Dust. No, I mean, contamination in general, these nanotechnology based solutions are generally very effective when it comes to low concentrations of contaminants. When something is very low concentration, arsenic is the effective concentration or the minimum concentration is 10 micrograms per liter, very tiny concentration. But it is a very, you know, high toxin. Now if, let us say, if this becomes 300, 400 ppb or 1000 ppb, then the amount of material required to remove that is quite large. So therefore, nanotechnology enabled solutions are very good for contaminants which are at the low concentrations. This is one point that you should. For iron removal, there are effective methodologies available already. and for which you don't have to invent new things. But then there are how fast iron can be removed, for example. Are you listening? How fast iron can be removed? That's an important problem. You don't have a lot of time to remove iron. So there are new materials that have come along, and nanotechnology enabled solutions are there as well. And if I were to extend your question, although you did not ask, there are many, many other contaminants. All of them, depending upon the kind of problem, concentration, the speed at which that you want to remove, extent to which that you want to remove, depending upon all of these, different solutions have come up. Iron included, fluoride included, uranium included, mercury included. Paul, you want to add something more?
Yeah, I would like to add something. You rightly told that when you go to any handbag, you find rust, which is mainly iron oxide. You should know that how this iron oxide is then on the hand pump platform. You see, because iron in ferrous form is then in groundwater, because groundwater lacks oxygen. So when we pump out this water, it gets oxygen from atmosphere and it oxidizes to ferric form, which precipitates. That's how you get this rust or iron on this platform. So similar technique is used in which you oxidize ferrous form to ferric form in treatment units also. By using this simple technology of aeration, you can easily remove, but there are other technologies also like catalytic oxidation, in which we use some catalyst to say enhance oxidation properties of iron so that this iron can be settled. So in CSIR also we have many technologies, NIRI, CGCRI, CIMERI. These technologies have been developed and implemented in India.
Dr. Pawan, I have a question for you. I want to ask. When we are using an RO system where it is not required, the consumer is losing a lot of money. He is losing out on a lot of minerals, and the country is losing out on a lot of water. So what are those conditions, what are those factors where the use of an RO system becomes absolutely necessary?
As I presented, and we know, as per GAIL standard also, the limit for TDS is 500 mg per liter. It's not that RO is bad, but it is primarily used in India to remove salt because there is no other alternate, let's say, cost effective technology. So as our committee also had recommended and NGT also had issued order, wherever we have less than 500 mg per liter of TDS and there is no other, say, contaminant also in water, we will use modern technology instead of using RO. It becomes essential, obviously, if the TDS is very high or more than 2000 mg per liter, which is a drinking water standard in India as per Bureau of Indian Standards. So in part of Rajasthan where we have very high TDS, similarly in Maharashtra also where TDS is high. At the same time, if you have multiple pollutants also where having individual technology becomes difficult for implementation, we can definitely go for solution of say membrane processes or RO.
Thank you.
What about a city like Delhi? Almost all houses have got RO. We've been treating
This is a very interesting question. So if you see, compare Delhi, I have been told that in many societies, other than the water supplied by Delhi Jal Board, you have bore well. And it has always been argued by industries that suppose if we are using or mixing our say water supplied by Delhi Jal Board with borewell water, can't we use RO? So my point is that that we should first identify what sort of water quality you have in your household and accordingly work out your solution. In case you find that the TDS is very high, then you can definitely opt for RO-based solution. But if you are happy with the water supplied by Delhi Jal Board, which has low TDS level, at the same time there is no pollutant except microbiological contamination, which gets they're in any distribution system, then you can simply go for pre-filtration plus UV solution, UV type of solution.
Yeah.
Morning, sir. My name is Umang Khanna and I am a graduate in civil engineering. And at present, I am working on my side project on designing a smart city. And my main focus is in conserving water. So I also pointed the same point that sir mentioned, that RO wastes a lot of water. That the pipeline that we have, we just fill it into the sink and it gets wasted. So I'm personally saving 500 liters of water every month just by putting a bucket of water under it. So why not design a city, smart city based on water conserving measures just by using the same technology? Niti Aayog report says that by just next year, 21 cities or states will have water scarcity just next year. So why are not we seriously working on it? Why it is a red alarm situation in our country? Why are not we serious about it? Why individual participation is not there? Why a committee is not formed that emphasizes the youth to think about it?
Maybe Dr. Swach Majumdar can answer this.
See, these committees, experts, these that and all are at governmental level, and we can recommend something, and mostly you can say it's a fairly impartial sort of things. The only thing, it has to come from within. Sir was asking that whether RO is required. Tell you a small example. After that, I'll come to conservation. You can sit.
Okay.
So, see, RO is not required. The main concern is, in Delhi area where salinity is not there, salt is not there. So if you have some apprehension of having microbial contamination, then older days we used to boil the water. That's a simple germ killing technique. Now since we have progressed, so nobody is interested in boiling the water. At that time, we'll see the Saas Bahu ka jhagra, serial, this, that and all. And how much gas consumption will be there, fuel consumption? If manual maintenance, you are spending some 5,000 rupees every year for domestic RO purifier maintenance. So I think if you have some time to boil it, so cost of your fuel will be much less, just for drinking purpose. And regarding your water conservation, see, India is such a vast country, so water conservation should be need and location specific. If you want to conserve the water in Mizoram by rainwater harvesting, it's going to be a disaster, even in Bengal. Because if you recharge it, there is no place to recharge groundwater. Groundwater is already full. If you push the water for groundwater recharging, rainwater, it will not go. It will come out. Domestic wastewater, you can reuse it, recycle it by some sort of treatment method. So grey water techniques are available, but all the techniques are involving some cost of operation. So it is may not be possible for every household to go for this kind of water conservation or recycling. But conservation and recycling are two different things. Conservation means if you have a luxury of having your overhead water reservoir and you can take a shower for half an hour singing 10 songs. Moment the corporation says that tomorrow I will not supply water, you will take bath with half a bucket of water because your apprehension comes that water will not be there. So this is a mindset. So water conservation mindset should come that every day I should not take bath for half an hour or 15 minutes or a simple thing like if you have a RO purifier in the kitchen and if you have a small pipeline, reject pipeline, you put it into your flush from outside. Toilet and kitchen may not be a long distance. So at least partially you can using that water. So this is, you are using the water.
Japan already invented the technology of sink toilet. they invented that technology of sink toilet. So basically, whatever water, hand washing and face washing we are doing, it directly goes into the sink, and we don't have to use fresh water to flush the sewage. We have to use the waste water that we have already used from our hands to flush the sewage. So that's how every time we flush the water, around 20 liters of water gets flushed away. And from every, we can say every household, at least about 5 times we flush the water this way. So we can save 100 liters of water per day from each and every house. If we take it in big terms, it could be many MLDs. So we can design something on that basis, but my basic question is, if I design something, how will I be able to present in front of the government or ministry of Jal Shakti ministry?
See, you can present a model. Smart city means you are going to involve smart devices to conserve water, to recycle water. Smart devices means you can use sensors, you can use intelligent monitoring system, you can use what is called IoT based things. But another advice is to go slow for that, because smart cities, the street lamps are fitted with sensor which is supposed to work in the evening, it should put on the light. In many cases it does the opposite. Daytime it sensor, and there is no agency or no people to take care of this sensor.
That's the biggest issue. So nobody takes care of
If you have a proposal for smart city involving this kind of things, there should be some sort of futuristic idea also, sir has asked, told about sustainable development, how we are going to sustain it. So that is one thing. So since you are doing a project for smart city, you please think of it also.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Sachs.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Rakesh, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, Professor Pradeep will also do, but this is a very important thing and a very relevant point. I think till date we have dependent on something which somebody else will do. And in a way, smart city has provided that platform where we need to connect each and every drop of water, each and every molecule of air pollution, and each and every aspect of transportation, each and every aspect of person who comes in and goes out of the city. Only when we connect all dots, we'll be able to manage. And I think what you pointed it out is absolutely necessary. India is a country which loves government rules. And if it's not there, they want to flout it. So we are not going to become sane on our own system. So what you have said is absolutely right. Even if a city does audit of how many cartridges are getting thrown from RO systems, that itself will give you a big idea of starting a company to manage the reject of ROs. And that we need to do it in a smart city for that matter. So I'll stop here. It's very extensive, and Professor Pradeep will add more on this.
It is not easy to take any technology to people. You know this very well. And what you just now said, that people are, my technology is getting damaged, who is taking care of it and all that, is if you are an entrepreneur, it's a great opportunity. You have to find a solution which is unbreakable. And if you have found that solution, you have to walk the hard way to find a solution while it implemented. It has not been easy for a professor like me, having I have produced some 40 and odd PhDs, 200 and odd scientists in my laboratory, lots of students I taught. But that is my job. But to produce a company or start something and take these technologies and implement and all that is not my job. But that's an extra walk that I have to do. If you are prepared to walk that extra mile, you will get rewards. But it's a hard walk. Please walk. Yeah? And please find more and more solutions. Now I have one more point to say. That people who walk this extra mile, they are the people who build companies. This Kent Aro was built by an IIT Kanpur graduate called Mahesh Gupta. Okay? And in 1998 he built something. That was a hard work for him. He is having something. You may have something to talk about it. Point is, RO or any such technology, today, when I look at it, the miracle RO has done. It's a great thing, I salute that. It's like, Boeing 747 flying. From 350,000, 35,000 ppm, 40,000 ppm, it is giving you this. Beautiful, at that cost. What is the cost today? It's nothing. Nothing. That has come to great extent the technology has evolved. Point is, in that process, there are issues. We have to address these. Making 5 rupees on the market is not easy. This man coming here, Dr. Raju, it's not easy in the market to make something. Today we find something, let's find solutions for it. Now people have this fear that, oh, all these companies, so many years, they were producing dirty water and killing people. No, nothing of that kind. They were helping us. We have issues today. We have better solutions today. We have to integrate them for the good of all. For that, I think institutions have to come together. Your question is right, relevant. You go and innovate. Like you, millions should innovate. And that's why CSIR and institutions like that are there. These institutions have to take technologies also. These guys have to come together with institutions and to build something better for tomorrow.
Thank you, Professor. I think this is a good time to bring in Dr. V.A. Raju, who is representing the Water Quality India Association. I would want to know what has been the industry's reaction to these NGT guidelines.
I think the industry is primarily in sync with what is going on. Okay, there's no question of dispute by virtue of saying that this is wrong. Okay, the industry also agrees that there are issues which require to be looked at. The industry is seriously looking at all those issues. There are challenges that happen with reference to making sure that all these guidelines and things are met with by each and every person. Because today if you see the RO industry, is such that we have something like about 60% of the sale that is happening of RO units through an unorganized sector.
We should talk about domestic RO.
Domestic. Point. We are talking about domestic point of view ROs. Okay, where it is a garage technology. We have people who don't know anything about the technology who make a product and sell it. And then they don't bother about looking after that product, they don't service that product, they don't understand the need for service, and consumers are taken in for a ride. See, at the end of the day, like Dr. Mujumdar was, removing his TDS meter from his pocket and showing it. TDS is not a measure of quality at all in terms of water. TDS is one of the parameters of the 68 parameters which IS 10500 talks about. Okay, it is only one element, and that's not the measure saying that, okay, if my TDS is 500 or my TDS is 300, my water is either good or bad. It isn't so. Okay, beyond that, we require to look, as Dr. Pawan is saying, we require to look at what the quality of water is. We have to actually test the water quality. And then look at what needs to be done in terms of using an appropriate technology. There are a variety of technologies available. Like RO is one technology, UV is technology, UF is another technology, simple filtration is another technology, activated carbon is another technology, resin media is another technology. So we have to be able to identify the problem by doing a proper water quality report. And then assessing the appropriate technology that needs to be put into place to solve that problem. Okay, there is no one technology which is like a magic wand which will take care of all the problems in water. We still don't have that. It is perceived that RO is something like that. Yes, majority of the components, as we have learned through the day, 90% is reduced when we use RO. Most of it is removed. All the salts are removed. We are learning that. And that is why basically people try to say that, arey, ye bhi ho sakta hai, ye bhi ho sakta hai, toh ye wapar lo. Without actually getting into whether it is needed or not. So it means a lot more education to people. We require to see that people are educated whether they need to have that technology or whether they can avoid that technology. Yes, RO does have a lot of wastage of water. But then there's not wastage of water. Every process, for example, you use water, you use a washing machine at home, for example. Okay, the amount of water that you waste in your wash, 70 liters of water you waste just for one wash. Okay, is that not waste? It is basically needed for doing a particular task. The task is you want clean clothes and you're using a washing machine which is using water. Similarly, to get pure water, you are using a technology which also will use some water in terms of a reject stream that is going to go out. We have all medicines, we have liquors that are manufactured which use hell of a lot of volume of water. Now, we don't consider that as waste. We consider that as process. Okay, similarly, RO is a process where we have some volume which is basically getting rejected out. Yes, the industry understands that if the rejection is going to be less, it's going to be better. Fine? So appropriate technology is required to be put into place to make sure that we are able to get higher recoveries. Like for example, the WPO has worked on an independent standard which started much before the NGT order started, in fact. Okay, NGT has now come out with an order, but we were working on this particular solution in terms of higher recoveries for RO systems much before the NGT order has come through. And we would be happy to tell you that tomorrow we are launching a standard for recoveries, for efficiencies. So there will be a star rating. There will be a 2-star rating, there will be a 3-star rating, there will be a 4-star rating for products which have got higher recoveries. Like how you have an energy saving star rating, you will have a star rating for water purifiers with higher efficiencies. So that's what the industry is gearing up to. Industry
in the organized sector.
In the organized sector. Okay, so the point is, yes, we require to see that people are more in the organized sector and there is a competitive spirit, more the merrier, but get organized, get standards into place, get standards which will help anybody and make sure that these standards are made mandatory. See, because the standard by itself, if it is going to be voluntary, is not going to help anybody. There are some standards which we need to make mandatory. Like in the electrical appliances, for example, a switch. If you have to have a switch, you have to have a... It's a compulsory standard. BIS has got a compulsory standard of safety. Likewise, thank for water purifiers...
I think you have made your point, Dr. Raju. You have made a wonderful point here. Thank you. We have just enough time to bring in two questions from two students.
You asked only for two.
One of the girls, maybe?
Good evening to all the excellencies and my colleagues. So, my question is to Dr. Swachh Pujandar. So, as you told that world's largest treatment plant is in Japan with capacity 5,000 meter cube per hour, and that's a ceramic plant. So, my question is that which is the second largest plant, which is the second largest treatment plant in the country, and India stands on which number?
Which one? In the world or in the country? Which country?
In the world.
Second.
Japan.
Yeah. What I showed, that is not the largest one.
So what?
What I showed, 5,000 meter cube per hour, that is not the largest one.
Oh.
Largest one is in Japan. It's a place called, I think, Japanese Higaku or something like that. I give you a clue. You search for meta water. Write down meta water. Meta water website, you search, you will get the treatment plant capacity. That's the biggest one, and they have the second largest one.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Next question.
My name is Pavni Sharma. I am from Kendriya Vidyalaya Gold Market. My question is to Dr. Sachin Majumdar. As you said that Virat Kohli uses drinking water came from Australia. What is the difference between India water purification and Australia water purification?
See, there is no difference in technology as such, supposed to be, because the technologies, Bisleri or Kent or other companies, Aquafina, they are using, those are very good quality, right? But only difference is that
You don't know whether the bottle of Bisleri you are buying, whether really it is the original one or spurious one. That is one point. In India, there is no mechanism to check the adultery. Okay. About Virat Kohli's highs of tone, that alkaline water is what he said, that slightly maintain the pH at a higher level, it is close to around 8. So alkaline pH water, now it's a trend. Now many people are telling that you should drink alkaline water, but there is still controversy. How you make the alkaline water? You can have some sort of slow releasing beads, where in controlled nutrients, in controlled mechanism, are slowly released into the water. In your household water also, you can make it alkaline by putting those small beads. Those are manufactured in South Korea or countries like that. Those are being imported. So that is the alkaline water. But Virat Kohli, when he goes to Australia, he drinks Australian water. But I think when he is in India, he drinks Indian water.
Thank you. What are the girls from here?
Good evening to all. I am Riya from JNV Jafarpur. I want to ask a question from Dr. Pavan Kumar. How can we maintain water treatment system and can we use raw water for anything?
Can you use raw water for
anything?
I think she means reject water.
Can we use raw water for anything?
Raw water which you get in your home?
Wells, right? Water that comes from wells, can you use?
Hindi mein bolna chahenge aap ki theek hai. Okay. First of all, see, raw water, if it is of good quality, you might have seen historically, if you talk to your, say, grandparents, how was he drinking water? He was directly drinking water from the well, because that time, yeah, first of all, there was no awareness. But at the same time, there was no, say, contaminant other than geogenic contaminant in water. So we were not using pesticide, we were not using other contaminants also. That's why the water might have been safe. So they were directly using. In case if you do testing of your water and find out there's no contaminant, then you can directly use raw water. So yeah, that another question I
sir, how can we maintain water treatment system?
Okay, see, I talked about point of use water treatment system. Dr. Raju is from here. Some good companies have their own mechanics. They go to your household periodically. Suppose if you have to repair or maintain your system, every 6 months so these people go and then clean your pre-filtration system. They also ensure that, okay, the membrane, if you're using RO, they ensure that membrane is not broken, there's no damage to membrane, and the water quality you are getting out of this treatment system is also good. So some of the, say, periodic maintenance is required for all the treatment system, as we do with our vehicles. Similarly, we have to do it with our water treatment system. By having this maintenance in place, we can always use this point of use water treatment system if your water quality is poor.
Thank you. Very, very quickly, one more here.
Thank you to all. My name is Richa Kumari and I am from JNV Jafarpur. My question goes to Professor Pradeep. Some people in our country want to conserve water and they want to spread awareness between the people to conserve water who waste fresh water. But the people who waste water, some of them are not aware to conserve water. How have we aware them?
My girl, awareness has to come from the very early stage. From childhood. I'm 56 years old. At 56, I should not get great awareness overnight. I should get that very early. We have to start building this awareness from the schools, from families. How will you be a better citizen? By probably better education at home. So we have to have such practices starting from homes, and schools have to start doing that. Nation has to do that. It is only by that way we can build awareness. I like this great idea that on this table there are no water bottles. Right? Only water. It's a great thing. So awareness has to start from homes. Awareness has to start from our own neighborhood. We build that. And you become a participant in that. And that is how the nation will change.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor. I think we have no more time now.
Some of the speakers have to have a flight actually at 8 o'clock. But, yeah, you can write in the questions, we can have the answers. Many of them have to. Thank you, panel, for really the wonderful discussion. I think let's give a big round of hands to all of us. I think in the beginning we promised the students that we will give some prizes. So all those students who ask questions can please come to the stage. This magazine is published by NISK, which is popular student. Hassan is the science editor. So we are giving them 1 year subscription. So I request the panelists to give it to the Chennai and from Kolkata and Pune. Thank you so much, and I'd like to thank Dr. Hassan Khan for moderating the panel discussion, and a special thanks to the teachers and principals of Kendriya Vidyalaya and Jawaharlal Vidyalaya who really sent the students for this wonderful session. And I would like to thank our industry participants and from DIS and Vikyan Prasar and media persons who attended this seminar. And also the CSIR support team of IT, USD, and various other people who have helped us in this event. And thanks to all the students who really participated in this event.